Hey, I got it turned on.
Hello.
Number two, button is on.
Hello.
Well, hello.
Hi, Buzz.
Hi.
Mike, are you plugged in over there?
Everybody, no, he's still not on.
Mike's microphone's not working. Hi, everybody. Don and Mike show.
Hi, everybody. My microphone doesn't work.
Mike, fortunately, I've planned for just this happenstance. You know, no puke sound effects. Oh, you got him on mic three? Hello? There you go.
Hi, Don.
Hey, Mike. This is kind of how I'm feeling.
Yeah, all of us are.
How you doing?
Talking to myself and feeling
old. Well, yeah. It is Monday.
How you doing, Donnie?
Sometimes I'd like to quit.
And it's raining.
Nothing ever seems to fit.
Oh, like my pants.
Hanging around.
That's all I do.
Nothing to do but frown.
Oh, Christ.
Rainy days and Mondays always get me down.
And now, speaking of depressed, here's our here's our engineer, Wendell. Wendell Hall. Hi, Wendell. What are you doing?
Are you going to mic two here? What's wrong?
Fix the mic? I don't know.
No working.
Went to turn it on, and I get, see, it's still not working.
No worky.
Rats.
No worky on microphone two.
That's what we said. I heard a crackling.
Shucks.
Yeah.
Some kind of lonely cloud.
Hey, let's hear the hook.
Rainy days and Mondays always get me down.
Aren't you people who used to complain about the puke sound effects? Aren't you wishing they were here now?
Absolutely.
Sure would cheer up this song.
Buzz, I know that we do a national show and that out in California it's sunny and it's hot. And
I'm sure.
In many locations it's beautiful. I would tell you here in D.C.,
yeah,
it's Monday and it's raining and it's 45 degrees outside.
And it's May.
What?
Yes, it's 45. It's 45
what
degrees.
Is, what is it, 51?
Yeah, it's 51.
It's 51.
I thought it was 58.
Oh, drop to 50.
I think it's very nice outside.
What's the weather phone number?
WE6 121 Clue.
Shut up. What is
it?
Give it to me in American.
936
1212, right?
Is that working now, Wendell?
Oh, no. Anything?
Hey, there you go, microphone number two. Hey, thanks, Wendell.
Thank you, Wendell.
I might have to go to a Happy Carpenter song now.
Don't
forget
hey,
to
that's great.
This cable sounds great.
And it's pretty.
It's red.
We're just waiting to hear the weather now. I think it's 45.
Even they're too depressed to answer.
Mike thinks
welcome
it's 58.
To the latest weather forecast brought to you by Verizon. The current temperature in downtown Washington is 48.
2 p.m. the temperature at National Air.
There you go.
48.
What a start to the week. We're getting competitive, but it's 5 minutes into the show. Yes, John, you were right. I was wrong.
Just telling you, dude. Monday is rainy. It's cold.
Talking to myself.
It is.
Talking to myself.
Look at the way I dressed today. I dressed like it's 80.
Yeah, why?
I don't know.
Anyway.
Now I'm all depressed after that music.
Oh,
I have the perfect remedy for that.
You have something to pick me up?
Hello.
Hello.
Oh, jokes. Monday, May 3, 2004. Jokes.
I think we're all in the mood for some prepared comedy, Miss Hathaway.
Hello, Mr. Drysdale.
Hello, Mr. Shannon. Ready for that prepared sheet of comedy that you're going to share with the listening audience? Money.
Donald Trump has proposed to his girlfriend, Melanie. Melania. Melanoma. It's rare Donald commits to anything except his vow never to see a good hairdresser.
Oh, my God.
That's what I'm helping.
Hello. The FBI issued a warning for Los Angeles, people shopping in malls on the city's west side because of a terror threat. FBI officials want residents to report any unusual behavior at the malls, like someone actually going into the Hickory Farm store.
There's that same California guy.
And I know that you guys do love the Barry Bonds jokes.
You got another Barry Bonds one?
You got one?
Did you hear... A sheep in New Zealand was shown on TV after developing nearly 60 pounds of wool. I'm not suggesting anything, but the sheep weighed only 9 pounds before spending the summer grazing in Barry Bonds' yard.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
And these are the best.
Another Barry Bonds joke.
And they went a long way for
These
that
are
one.
The best. From And, Robbie, how long do you think they're going to continue to send this great stuff to us?
I've tried to cancel it five times.
They won't have it.
No.
We insist you read this garbage.
Kirby, hold on. We do have a call before we actually even start the show.
Oh, really? That's...
Mike.
Don and Mike.
Hey,
listen.
Yes.
A couple things real quick. First of all, I'm calling from the Legacy. I cannot hear you, so I'm sorry.
Right. And Philly, we're sorry about that, too.
Yeah. You guys rock, and that's for Tim.
Oh, screw him.
To top it off, happy Maytallica.
It's Maytallica.
The first Maytallica call.
All right, guys, I'm punching out.
That's funny.
Care, dude.
Hey, you know, you got to like it when you get a call from a market where we're not on anymore.
That's pretty cool.
And the guy's got something funny to say.
There you go. Hey, Mike. Hey, now.
The Don and Mike Show.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe.
All right, and here they come. And,
hello.
Here's Julie with all of her uncles. Hi, guys. Okay, hi.
Hello.
Hi. Oh, here we go. Tell them.
He was a neo-Nazi with one true enemy.
Hello.
Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. His soul torn apart. Viewer discretion advised.
And good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. They are scared of beds and all the ships at sea. Meet two guys who were ready to audition for 10.5 until they found out it wasn't a measurement in inches.
Yeah.
Dr. Geronimo. You know, you should have said it on Saturday. Rabbit, rabbit, rabbit. If you didn't, your life is doomed this month.
That's right.
Don and Mike Show, new episode on this Monday.
Monday!
05, 03, 04.
Hi, Don and Mike. Buzz Burbank here.
Howdy, Buzz.
May 3rd, odd 4.
That's right.
Here's how you can call us from any city that's airing the show in North America, in America, I should say. 877-365-3636, North America. That's that Canada thing, right?
No, we're all North America. We and Canada are North America.
Yes. So Canada, you can call 800-636-1067. And Washington, D.C., you can call us at 202-432-1067, where we're heard on 1067 WJFK every day. Lots of weekend stuff to tell you about, even though I had a weekend without my family. My family was so involved in my weekend.
Really?
Yes. Well, not my immediate family, but my family. My whole
cotton
picking family. I have to start today's show, though, with this big bit of showbiz news.
Hmm.
And, yes, he did get his start on the Don and Mike Show.
Okay.
He will fascinate you. His name is not John O'Grady.
No.
His name is... John Maynard.
Huh.
You know the Tron guy?
Yeah. Jay Maynard?
Yeah. Did I get it wrong?
The guy with the body suit.
Yeah.
Jay Maynard.
Well, that's not going to endear him to us. Discovered on the Don and Mike Show tonight,
mm-hmm.
he makes his national TV debut on Jimmy Kimmel. And we will be speaking to him in about 2 hours when he gets off the airplane in Los Angeles.
Very, very exciting.
Wonderful.
Spoke to him this morning.
And how is, I said, John, but it's Jay, how is Jay Maynard doing, Robbie?
He said, I realized everyone would take their shots, but now that it's reached this proportion, I thought I'd best just sit back and enjoy the ride.
Yeah.
Well, he's smart. So this is the guy that you heard on the show a couple of weeks ago. Some doofus on the internet who made a Tron costume, and now...
There goes tonight, Jimmy Kimmel ripping us off again.
On Jimmy Kimmel, almost live. Today we'll call him at some point. And, Buzz, I know that we often don't talk about your weekend.
True.
But I do want Buzz to mention one thing that happened to him.
Okay.
He was telling me up in the office before the show, it's not unusual to be loved by anyone. It's not unusual to have fun with anyone.
Buzz spent the weekend with Tom Jones?
No. Yes. It's not unusual for Buzz to go somewhere and like say, hi, I'd like a club soda, please. And, of course, they go, oh, you're the Buzz from the radio.
The voice.
Yes, yes. Buzz got recognized at a couple of places this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
But the final person to spot Buzz was perhaps the most right on. And, Mike, you'll appreciate this.
Okay.
Buzz, how many people at the first place said, are you Buzz from the Dynamite Show?
There
you
had
Buzz
to be at least five people, and considering it was a small roadside bar, I was surprised at the number. But, yeah, five people came up to me or inquired at some point.
Buzz Burbank. In our listening audience should realize that Buzz spends a tremendous amount of time just hanging out at roadside bars.
Oh, God help me.
Did.
I love him.
Looking for hitchhikers. He did, and it was some dive off Route 210, like off Indian Head Highway.
Really?
Yeah. Yes.
Murphy's Pub, a wonderful neighborhood bar, and saw Car 54, a great group there, and it was a nice time.
So tell everybody the next time you go out, last night.
Sunday night, went out to dinner again with John Normand, who comes into the studio occasionally, helps us out with the show, and his wife, Kelly. And we
Buzz is holding his egg again.
He's holding his egg again. This is where I get all my power from the egg. We went to a nice restaurant, a nice seafood restaurant, a couple of tables away
just
from it.
Just get to when the guy comes over and recognizes you.
Well, as we were leaving, a waitress comes up to me and goes, are you Surf?
That's true, right?
The local DJ Surf.
There you go.
Not me.
I bet you couldn't have been more flattered.
I was. After all the other recognition, that was the humbling experience.
Because you and Surf, even though you're not the same person, mm-hmm. you both served at the Battle of Bull Run.
That's true. That's true.
Right. Which is pretty cool.
You should have known you weren't Surf. You didn't have clogs on, did you?
No.
And you didn't
no
have clogs. Your hair plugs in.
No.
Your fingers weren't orange.
No. Didn't have that.
Anyway, that's funny that Buzz got recognized as Surf.
Yeah.
Here's my weekend. I'm going to tell you, it was, like I said, it was family, but it was not family because my wife had to work on Sunday, which meant that Saturday was out. I said, why don't we, the weather's going to be nice, go to the ocean. She said, no, why don't you go up to Ocean City by yourself? And thank God I got out of the house because she calls me on Saturday morning. She's got some, now she's already got the guys in the bathroom.
Right.
They're still week number eight now of the bathroom held hostage. However,
wow.
However, the toilet works. 2 months, the toilet works. She had, I don't even know what she's doing. Something with the floors, something with the varnishing and the polishing of the floors, and they got something wrong. And all I know is that I'm at Ocean City, Maryland.
Right.
I'm at the beach, but I'm enjoying myself.
Yeah.
And I get the call from her, and she says, "Oh God, I can't go up there, up and down the stairs for 6 whole hours." I said, "Why?" She said, "Well, I found a spot I didn't like, and they redid all of the floors." And I'm just saying thank you, Jesus, mm-hmm. that I'm not there. Mm-hmm. That I'm not there while this is going on.
Pandemonium.
Yeah, because...
Your house is... How long have you been building your house?
Always.
Always.
I mean, it's never completed.
Decades like of building the house.
It has never been completed. And no. And for being an introvert and shy and someone who likes my privacy, I've become so open to... The working man. Mm-hmm.
You basically walk around the house pantsless now, right?
I mean, where it used to be, I used to feel a little bit of a tinge of, I'm less than a man. I have other guys in the house, tearing up the bathroom and doing this. Not anymore.
Good. Would you get me a soda, please?
Good morning.
Could you make me a sandwich when you're done sanding?
Could you imagine if I was there on Saturday and I would have to scream? Kirk, could you go in the drawer and throw my underpants down, please?
Could you be a dear and get me a face cloth?
Oh, this is my wife. Hello.
Oh, sleepy, are you complaining?
My house started to decay before it was completed.
Yeah, right. It is kind of torn up. You weren't even here for most of it.
I was just saying that. Thank God I wasn't here for this weekend. So Saturday. Oh, God, Robbie, I called you first on Saturday. I'm sorry to. Well, with my new love, I went to the liquor store.
What'd you find?
And I found the name of the vodka is Effin. Effen. Uh-huh. I'm telling you, it is a combination of black cherry and vanilla vodka.
Wow.
It is high octane stuff.
Ooh.
And it tastes like, what's that candy, Rob?
Candy. I forget what you give me.
The lifesaver, the cream saver.
The lifesaver, cream saver.
Lifesaver, cream saver. That's what it tastes like.
Just yummy.
Oh, man.
You see, you're a man that just was in love with this vodka.
Yeah.
You're getting more like me every day. You know that.
I go with
Mike, this. Do you, here's a dumb question, but one I've never asked you about with your drinking habits.
Yes.
Do you drink alone?
No.
Are you telling the truth?
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, I don't remember the last time I
do.
Yeah, I know.
I remember the last time I drank alone. That'd be last night.
Yeah, Don doesn't fall in the same category as I do. I mean, I check a lot more boxes on the survey than he does.
Freda started busting my balls about this.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. At some point, I was just like, wow, this drink is fantastic. I can't believe I'm at the beach. It's sunny. I'm smoking a cigar. This drink is fantastic. She said, you're drinking alone? Yes. And she said, oh. She said, that's sad. I said, why is it sad? I'm happy.
Sounds you're content.
I'm very
happy. I think that they say you're getting into dangerous territory when you drink alone.
Well,
you regularly drink alone.
Well, I don't regularly drink alone. I regularly, well, I'm in our house. What do you mean, just because I'm not drinking with you?
You're alone in our house.
Who spilled the wine on the ceiling? You did. That had to be when you were
I drink alone once in a while.
Gotcha.
I'm drinking wine. That's
now,
the difference.
Here's what we want to get to
I
with you.
I drink wine when I cook.
Right. Here's
Julia Child.
Here's what we want to get to with you. I mentioned this on the show Friday. Now, I've not seen my wife since Friday.
Wow.
I mean, because I go to the beach. She worked yesterday. Yeah, Buzz give me the old thumbs up. She worked yesterday, so, you know, I was at the beach. I wait till Monday to come back. I've not had an in-depth conversation with her about the roller skating. Saturday afternoon we speak. She, for whatever reason, is unhappy because I'm happy because I'm in love with this drink. And she says, you're drinking by yourself. That's sad. I said, there's nothing to be sad about. I'm happy. I said, what are you doing? She says, oh, I'm going roller skating. I said, all right, well, have a good time. Bye. Click. And normally at some point, this is like at 6 o'clock on Saturday.
Right.
At some point during the evening, I'm thinking she's just going to give me the call just to say, hey.
A little update? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well.
Okay, the call never came?
I don't hear
it. Having a wonderful time.
You know
time.
My excuse for not being able to phone you.
And what was that?
It was that the floor on the wood stairs had been refinished, and my cell phone was upstairs, and I had to let it dry for 6 hours before I could walk on it. So I didn't have a cell phone Saturday night.
See, I guarantee you, folks, if situations return and I turn around and I was saying this, she'd say, I don't believe you.
Right.
Times 1,000%. Whatever. Listen, here's what I want to know. Honey, you're 48. You're beautiful. You're 48. What the hell are you going through? You want to go to the White House Correspondents' Dinner. Now you went roller skating on Saturday night. Who did you go roller skating with?
With friends from work.
With friends from work.
Hey,
hold on. We got some good roller skating music.
During my age range, if you're using the Mike O'Mara scale of friends in your age.
Remember Xanadu? I was a big roller skating fan.
Xanadu!
Anyway, darling.
And we want to do that. I mean, we're talking about next time finding a roller disco.
How old were your friends? You were saying you were using my scale?
Yeah, on your scale, we were all in the same age range.
So you're going out with...
Yeah, they're mostly... I would say mostly 20s.
Mostly 20s. And what is the fascination with roller skating? Where does
it come from? You know, I've always roller skated. I have my roller blades are at the beach. I've always liked roller skating.
Now, did you roller blade or roller skate?
Yeah, well, this was at a rink, and my roller blades are at the beach, so I rented roller skate. So this was skate.
Isn't it harder on roller skates than it is on roller blades?
You are crazy.
No, because
crazy.
But I started roller skating
you're
when I was
crazy.
In elementary school.
You're
you know,
fun.
I learned it on the streets.
I like you. You're crazy.
And I did tricks. I fell down. Do stupid tricks.
Wait. You're crazy. You're crazy.
Our favorite tape.
You're nuts. You're
if
just...
you would do things with me, I don't see what my... When I was a girl...
Again, hold on. You know, I love quoting Jerry Maguire. Mm-hmm. It's the one quote in a movie that I use with my wife in real life. What are the ABCs of me? The ABCs of me are I don't roller skate,
no,
honey.
You lied to me when we were engaged because you pretended like you roller skated,
sure.
And we roller skated downtown Washington.
I mentioned that, and I was wrapped around a pole down on M Street, so you
didn't
know
you do that. Didn't you do that with golf, too?
Yeah, I lied about golf. Yes. I lied to Frida's family about golf.
Yeah. So you led me to believe that you did stuff.
Because
I didn't find out till after we got married that you don't do stuff.
Okay, but I'd say you've had 23 years though to discover that.
Yes.
Yeah, but like now I made a commitment to you, so I'm with a man who doesn't do anything.
There you go.
Who drinks by himself and won't do anything with me.
Listen, I can't tell you how good I'm feeling right here.
Yeah.
When I, you know, right deep inside, where at that spot where self-respect lives, I can't tell you how good I'm feeling because you know, here I am just getting out of your hair so you can work or whatever. I'm not busting your chops.
Oh, yeah,
about...
you're doing me a favor by going to the beach. Is that the angle you're playing? You're getting out of my hair?
I believe if you and I had been in the house when you had guys coming over and making the floors unwalkable, I think, yeah, we would have had...
Sugar Bear.
We would have had a domestic disturbance.
No, but you don't... You're putting the chicken before the egg or the horse before the horse before the car. The guys weren't going to finish the floor until you weren't there. Then they were there. I said, well, why not go ahead, you know, because no one's here this weekend.
All I know is that you're nuts, that you're going to strip clubs, you're going to roller skating.
Now, if you can get some of those strippers on roller skates, now you got something.
Yeah. Now you got something. And meanwhile, the crazy life that I'm leading...
Oh, there goes another spill.
Here's why I am crazy. You know, I'm at the beach. I'm a single, successful, married guy.
Single?
I said single, successful, married guy.
Right.
I'm a single, successful, married guy. I'm at the beach. You know what I did yesterday? Spent the whole day with my mother-in-law.
There you go.
That's right.
You're a good man, Charlie Brown.
The little girl in my man's life.
Yeah.
To quote Mike Douglas.
Did you dance?
No, we didn't. No, you still remember that one time I danced with her.
It was one of my favorite moments all with you and your mother-in-law.
No, she bought a new condo a while ago, and I was like the only person I think in the family who hadn't seen it.
Is it made of stone?
It's a condo made of stone. King Tut.
Something's wrong with me today.
No, you're
yeah,
fine.
Okay, I'm just checking.
I think it's that cord, Mike.
It's the red cord.
The red cord.
It's the red cord today.
Bringing out the crazy part in you, Mike.
If you're feeling bad because, you know, I made you feel guilty because you're not doing stuff with me, well, just be in on the next outing. You're always invited.
But I don't want to do that crap. I don't want to go roller skating. I told you, if you want to go out to dinner, you want to go out to drinks with people, you want to go to a movie with people, I'm fine. I don't want to go roller skating. And I don't want to go to a strip club with you.
Then we could go I want to go see the female impersonators.
The female impersonators.
Right.
These are. You want to see fags?
Well, I guess I don't care if they're gay or not. I mean, they're female impersonators. They do a good show.
You'd enjoy that. It's like the Birdcage.
What about the good old days when it used to be enough? Okay. There would just be a movie out that.
I'll throw something else out I'm working on with another friend.
Oh.
I do like a weekend Zen retreat meditation Buddhism thing.
We weren't supposed to tell him about that yet.
Oh, that'd be fine with me. It's just another weekend I could be alone to drink.
Yeah, I'm saying you could come
Mike
with.
Mike O'Hara's Zen weekend.
What?
What was that?
Oh, that was the boy.
Oh, the boy. There we go. I was wondering. You know, now it's a man sound when he laughs like this.
Yeah.
He's part of the reason I'm busy outside the home a lot.
And, you know, I don't even want to discuss him on the show.
Okay, good.
I don't want to even discuss him on the show.
He's a sweetheart.
You keep telling yourself that.
Okay.
Listen, I love him, too. You know, honey, I don't want to go down this road today.
Okay, good.
Listen, you're nuts. I don't know. So, the roller skating, you liked it? You didn't like it?
I had a blast.
You had a blast.
Oh,
okay.
Hey, you know where you could go? You could go to the new Air and Space Museum.
Well, I would like to see that.
I went there this weekend. Don't give me that. I'm getting double flipped off.
I know a great roadside bar.
I don't like going to museums. You know what I'm doing on the weekend? I like sitting down, watching TV, getting good and loaded.
Good for you. You're a man that knows what he likes.
That's what I like on the weekend.
Loaded.
And yesterday...
Is someone really drinking alone when they're making frequent phone calls to someone who is also drinking alone?
Yeah, how do you
like being together?
Were you drinking too?
Mike.
You can't say alone, you should check the phone record.
Every 2 seconds. Well, see, technically you're really not then.
Yeah. It's true.
Anyway, you're nuts. You're Bizarro Frida. That's all I want to say to you.
Sugar Bear, when are you going to start doing things with me? I mean, I'll let you decide, as long as it doesn't involve TV, doesn't involve a movie, unless it's like an artsy movie or downtown or dinner.
See, this is the problem with you. You're crazy. I'm not saying it like that. Just
you're crazy. You're crazy.
I'm not a cultured man.
I'm not asking for culture. I'm just asking for different.
I'm sorry. You want different, honey? Go down the street. There's like 8 million other difference out there. You got me.
No. I want you to go with me to something new without going to the same Cineplex every time we go out.
What's wrong with that?
And the same, although I love the Palm, I'd like to go to a different
restaurant. We've gone to those restaurants you like where you get a nice quarter portion and you pay four times the price for it.
I want to go to ethnic, you know, last night I had...
That's where I draw the line. No ethnic. No ethnicity.
You're American.
It's whatever you want. You want to go to...
Go to the restaurant she likes
you want
so
to go
bad.
I'll go to the different restaurants. You want to do that? I'll do that.
Okay, research it. Make some reservations.
I don't want to research it. I just want you to do the research.
I have a question about ethnic restaurants.
Yeah.
That's a joke. Is Irish ethnic?
Yes.
Honey, hold on. The other hotline.
You'll always have a table.
Hold on a second.
have the corned beef?
Yes, they still have the corned beef.
There you go.
You always can have a table waiting for you at Hank's Look Around Cafe.
All right, listen, whatever it is, you know, I guess this is just a new phase of our life now. And you know what I've noticed? That for the year that the boy was gone to college, the 8 months he was gone, it seemed that whatever these flaws are that I have that you don't like, you liked them fine when he wasn't around. But now that we're back to this dynamic of being the nuclear family,
now all of a sudden
I'm hearing the stuff again about, oh, but you got to do this with me.
You don't have to do anything, sugar. I am very happy doing stuff with friends from work and other things. You can be happy. You can just keep the home fires lit. I'm just saying if you feel bad and you want to do it with me.
If I feel bad in what regard? See, she's playing the mind game.
No, you just said to me, oh, I feel really great now when I was telling you about what I was doing. It made you feel bad. All I want you to know is you're always welcome. You're not necessary.
Wow. And again, thank you.
Okay. Thanks.
I don't know how to tell you thanks.
You can't be necessary and stay home. So if you want me to be happy.
Yes, you can. You can be. Listen, Jesus Christ, it's been every freaking moment of my life trying to keep you happy.
You don't have to. Relax. I'm happy. It's not dependent on you. You can stay home, watch TV, and I'm still happy.
This is a good one. I don't say that very often.
Okay.
This is a pretty interesting one here.
I'm telling you, what you're seeing is that you're seeing the unraveling of a mind, and it's not my mind that's unraveling.
I'm busy. I'm happy.
When you were a kid, you ever take a golf ball apart to see what's inside?
Sure did.
That's what's happening in my wife's head right now.
It's a baseball
team. Right now, yeah.
You can't stand it that I'm happy. Is that the problem?
No, I love it that you're happy.
Okay, then we have no problem. And I don't mind if you stay home, so we have no problem.
Fantastic. Then why'd you run me the attitude about Mother's Day? When I said to you yesterday,
I said I don't want to go out for brunch. I don't like to eat a big meal.
No, and you said to me, "Oh, and I'm starting my new fasting." It's like what? What the hell's going on with you? Going roller skating, going discoing, gonna go to strip clubs? I can't go out for Mother's Day brunch like we do every year because I'm fasting. Who's changing here? Who's changing here? Who's been the person who's always been happy staying at home?
You know me, I have always dieted. That's nothing new.
Now I'm going to get tons of calls like this. You answer this guy. Scott.
This is Don Geronimo Jr.
Yeah.
Man, I just went through the whole same thing. I am you to a T. I smoke cigars. I drink alone. I don't like doing all those things that Freda and Freda Jr. over here like to do. And she left me.
Your wife left you?
Oh, yeah. She left because I wouldn't bend, and we're stupid. We're stubborn. We don't listen to them. Don't let me take you down that same road. You gotta listen to her a little bit.
Oh, come on. I thought you were on my side. Hey, grow a set, pal. Hey, pal, grow a set.
She left you?
Girl. Yeah, she took those with me, too.
You call yourself Mike O'Mara Jr. that.
Yeah, hold on. I was just going to say, I'm a lot like Mike, too.
Get out of here. Get out of here, you dope.
Wow. And I like to do all those things.
Yes, darling.
I'll sound like Billy Joe. Don't go changing. I mean, and just disregard the fact that Billy Joel did leave that wife that he said that to. But don't go changing for me. I love you just
Billy Joel
are.
Left like two wives. Okay, he was with the first one. And then when he was really happy, he sang Uptown Girl for Christie Brinkley. And then that ended. There's another crazy woman that said to Billy Joel all of a sudden, hey, I just can't deal with the fact that what you like to do is
smoke cigars and drink alone.
Uh-huh. And then look at poor Billy Joel. He's driving his car into some dude's house the other day.
That's right.
Look at that.
if you don't mind the fact that I go out without you, I don't mind the fact that you want to stay home. So we're both happy, correct?
I don't. I just don't understand what it is you're doing.
Well, you don't need to. I don't understand why you like to watch TV and smoke cigars. You know, it's not necessary to understand me. You love me, I love you. That's all we need.
All right, crazy lady.
All right.
All right.
I didn't even tell you about the email I got from the doctor asking me out.
Oh, what email is this?
Oh,
you know, see, what is this?
She's working you now.
I know she is.
She's working
just,
you.
Someone I met at work, and a shopper, you know, after I greeted him.
Jesus.
And
so that's nice.
It's the doctor from the Burbs.
That's nice. So how does a guy who, at, and I know you don't want to talk about where you work and what you do, and I'll respect that.
I have a business card, with a work email address.
And what, like, he didn't notice that ring that took me 2 years to say four on your hand?
I told him I was there. Bye. See y'all. Thanks, Kirk. Bye.
Well, they're talking to more working guys.
Yeah.
We're all done here today. They come down with their overalls without any shirts on.
All of that supplied by the right. by the schmuck who just... Hold on a second.
Thanks for the lemonade, Mrs. Soros.
I got to get going.
No. You have to tell me about this email now.
It was nothing. That's why I don't usually tell you. That's why I tell you on the air. It was nothing. I ignored it. He said.
That's smart. Some guy, some perv, gets your email, sends you an email, asks you out, and why write back?
Dearest Freda, I've admired you from afar for a long, long time. I'm wondering if perhaps over coffee or perhaps a light supper, we could get to know each other better.
Yeah, I mean, why take the time to write him a note back that says, you know, Dear Julio,
I have enclosed a naked photograph of myself.
Dr. Julio.
Dear Dr. Julio, you seem like a nice man, but maybe you didn't know this. I'm already married to the most wonderful husband in the world.
He knew I was married.
Asked you out?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
well,
why don't you know about men?
Freda,
this
is day after day of looking in ears and up people's noses.
I'm serious. You can get bent. You can go to hell on this. If there is a doctor who's emailing you that he wants to go out on a date.
One email.
Hold on.
You're telling me to get bent because I didn't do anything.
It's the principle. Yeah, you send him an email back that says,
okay.
Hey, dear Harry Perv, you know,
All right, thanks.
I'm married.
All right, I've got to go. I'm bent now.
But it's better to play it your way to keep his fantasy going.
The get bent, I think she's gone with that one.
Oh,
and you wanted to...
Screw her and the broom she rode into the show on today.
I knew it was ramping up to be a good one when it started.
Yeah.
When it started.
God. You know, who knows? Who knows what that broad's doing?
Well, she just threw the little email thing at you at the last second.
They like to drop the little bomb at the end.
He's
a married guy who knows that she's not married, but he knows she's married, but he asked her out.
Hey, but I think all the men in the room are with you and in the audience right now. You don't ignore. You send the email back.
Yeah, right.
Excuse me, I happen to be a happily married woman.
Hello, Broomhilda, if you're still listening, you don't tell me that on the radio. Jesus. Embarrass me in front of a reporter.
Oh, my God.
I told you, my wife...
So how was your weekend?
Mine was great.
Mm-hmm.
Mine was great.
You and your new friend, Effin.
Yeah. And my mother-in-law. And I spent time with my brother-in-law and my sister-in-law. I spent all of them normal people. None of them who feel the need to go to strip clubs or to go rollerblading or to have doctors ask them out on the internet and then not even have the decency to send them a note back saying, hey, perv, I'm married.
A cigar, effing, your mother-in-law. come on now. I'm talking about a brand of vodka.
I heard the comma.
Thank you. I could not resist.
All right. Well, that's what you did this weekend.
You heard the comma. Thank you, Buzz.
I heard the comma, too. I just didn't say
that's good. I think that's fine.
Anyway, that's... That's it. And, I had a marvelous time at the outlets.
Really?
Yeah.
You went outlet shopping?
Yeah.
That doesn't sound like you.
Well, I needed something.
Uh-huh.
Looking for a wife. I'm looking for the store that says new wife. No, look at this.
Wives for sale.
How pathetic I am. Look at this. See this? This was my weekend.
That's a lovely bag.
I went to the outlets.
That's a lovely purse.
To buy the very same bag that I've had the last 3 years.
It looks exactly like the other one.
Yeah, it does. I love it. It's fantastic.
Keeping the wife, but got a new bag.
Okay. Nice leather.
Anyway.
At outlet prices.
Well, that's the weekend. And that segment didn't turn out exactly the way that I thought it would. But that's
well, you could have had a weekend like mine and been, really just if inadequate all weekend when I not all weekend, but for, the most important part of my weekend, my big auction where I had to follow a, big celebrity. And everybody told me how great the big celebrity was last year at this auction. And then I had to come up there and, it was terrible.
Yeah. It was Terry Bradshaw, right? The guy that did the auction last year?
Yeah, at Bushwood, at my fancy country club. They asked me, and, when they ask you at these places.
Were there any doctors there, Mike?
There were lots of doctors there.
Well, I'm gonna need the yellow pages.
Oh?
Open to D.
For doctors?
I'm afraid I'm going to have to spend the next 4 hours every commercial break. Simply calling every doctor.
Every doctor. Did you send it? Are you a little preoccupied with that?
A little. Just a touch. We have to break anyway, but then we can hear about
it. I'll tell you about my story in exactly, I found out where I am on the pecking order. Mm. Let me put it to you that way. And
so have I, incidentally. we're all learning. It's a big learning experience for all of us this week.
That and the only other thing I have to tell you about when we come back, I want to tell you about the fact that I've got a bone to pick with Boiled Egg Boy over here.
Oh, with Robbie?
Really? Yeah.
What, did you try his internet formula?
I did.
I'll tell you
what the result was.
And, huh?
Bet you did it wrong.
Yeah,
and every time I do it, it's right. The perfect hard-boiled egg.
All right. All right.
And are we split on The Sopranos before we go to break?
I know you and I are very definitely split on The Sopranos.
I did not like it. Mike?
I thought it was the best episode, one of the best I've seen.
Robbie?
I did not like it.
Buzz?
I liked the half I saw that wasn't blacked out by the storm.
Oh, Buzz.
Yeah.
Oh.
But I know about the gay mobster. So.
Well, before we go to commercials, I do want to say, who can really boil an egg well is Terry Bradshaw.
Oh,
I'm going to send you a bottle of vodka.
We will be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Me? That's why the bosses sent me out here. They wanted me to make sure none of the other crews robbed the joint. Like these two balloon heads over here. They were going to try to bang us out of 200 grand? Yeah, right, I'm sure.
The Don and Mike Show. World-class dancers, Don and Mike.
Yeah, yeah, so listen, we're giving away two trips to L.A. today. Los Angeles for the 2004 Taurus World Stunt Awards. Two nights, 3 days, hotel accommodations, event passes to see the show at Paramount Studios Hollywood. 2004 Taurus World Stunt Awards, hosted by Dennis Hopper, will be on Wednesday, 26th May, 9 p.m., 8:00 on Spike TV. First network for men. We'll give away two of those trips today, and our own Stump Man, Dennis Murphy, will be going to Los Angeles with you.
Yeah, and maybe Dennis will perform some stumps.
The Sopranos.
Yes.
Now, listen, here's the thing. Where I'm watching the show and just thinking that the guy that writes it thinks I'm stupid.
Now, I don't understand you.
And here's what I mean.
Okay.
I understand that Tony has had a reason for the panic attacks. I've watched every episode for the last 5 years. I understand what's going on with him and Carmella. I get the dynamic that they're trying to show us.
Mm-hmm.
But here's what I don't want. It's like I'm watching a soap opera, or even worse, an episode of Star Trek. Because here's what would happen on Star Trek The Next Generation. They would be in some impossible situation, and you look at your watch and go, there's 10 minutes left. There's no way. They come back from commercial, and Picard goes, number one, I remember the Vericius system. Send out torpedoes. And boom, they blow the thing up, and they go away. I'm watching this. I'm waiting for something. What do I get from Tony Soprano?
What?
That he had a panic attack when his mom...
I had a panic attack after my mother yelled at me.
And that's what's been...
I laughed my ass off when that happened.
That's what's been torturing him all these years, and that's why he treats, Steve Buscemi different. And it's just so... Soap opera, Oprah, repressed memory.
I don't know why I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it mostly because of
Vito, or what's his
Vito,
name?
I think it was the guy.
Yeah.
Vito in the compromising position with the security guard. You gotta love moment.
His name is Vito, and that's also his second great moment this year. Because remember, Christopher threw a sandwich at him.
The thing about Vito, but it
the
also,
gay stuff is great,
and I like the fight. I like the fight when they were at the. I loved. All the stuff where they're at the construction site. I love Paulie Walnuts coming up and saying to the kid, hey, kid, what did they do my tires? Take my tires and get to make sure it doesn't get in there. And then he finds out and he gives him money. You know what I mean? It was very mobsterish.
Right. Yeah.
And I like the guy sitting around the construction site because to me that's when it gets more mafia.
And see, to me that's not mafia. That's just a bunch of Goombas sitting around. I mean, you know what mafia is? Uh-huh. Mafia is you're going around somewhere. You got Goombas going somewhere.
And whacking somebody.
And suits and, you know, like got some Korean guy down there, got your foot on his throat going, hey,
right.
You know, hey, where's my effing money? I mean, that's mobster.
And then at the end when he has the breakthrough, it was just and you know what? You always talk about they're leading up to something. I felt the tension on that show starting to really build with who's the boss from New York?
Oh, with Johnny Sack? Yeah.
Johnny Sack, who, you know,
now that,
if you're lying to me, Tony, and then he's looking at the other Tony who went out on his own and did this hit.
Well, Johnny Sack already knows that Tony's lying to him.
Right.
Right? I mean, he doesn't know, but he knows.
And Johnny Sack, for some reason, creates the most danger on that show of any guy that I watch. He makes me think something bad's going to happen every time you see him.
I just wish I could be more positive about this week's episode.
And then it was kind of cool with Carmella at the end.
I liked everything except Tony's breakdown. When Tony, my mother yelled at me. Not a breakdown, his breakthrough.
Right.
You know, come on. Don't treat me, the viewer, like I'm an idiot. Come up with something. That's not something I'll see on One Life to Live. Right?
That's why it's funny on a mobster, to me. In other words, it's not something you expect to hear from a mobster. That's why I think the Oprah-type stuff is
funny.
But here's
the thing.
I was
touched. Can't they be... You were not. Can't that guy, David Chase, can't he be more clever?
I mean, didn't think it was not clever.
Does it? Oh, are you kidding me? He's just sitting in a room, and all of a sudden it's like, oh, hold on. It's my mother. It's my repressed memories.
Well,
I was afraid of my mother. Oh, my God, Dr. Melfi.
Yeah. He lied about what it was. He said he got roughed up, and you know.
Yeah, I saw it. I heard his story. I just thought it was jive.
I think you guys are missing the main fault last night. It's too much Meadow.
Well, you know, there is room for debate on that.
Meadow run around in her shorts.
Me either.
But you gotta hate that boyfriend.
But
that was good.
You do hate the boyfriend, but that's why he's in all the gangsters.
Yeah, that's why he's there for you to hate him.
Don't you think that kid played fear just about as well as anybody can play fear when he gets greeted at the porta potty by Vito? This was good stuff because you don't know. You didn't know whether Vito was going to kill him at that moment.
Right.
You weren't sure what was going to happen. You know?
I'm in agreement with you 95% of what you're saying.
And I understand that you felt that. They insulted your intelligence with the Tony thing. I'm going to give you a pass on that one because I really can't.
And I don't mean
that. I can see your point on that. But the rest of the episode, you know, was very gangsterish, I thought.
Mm. But not, Mike, God, what happened to all the arguments we've had over the years? Not really gangsterish.
Well, the fight was fantastic.
The fight in past years, you would have said about that fight.
Right.
I can't use the word anymore.
They might as well have been dancing, right?
Yeah.
That's what I would have said. It was good.
Better,
you know, maybe it was my relief at not having to see Carmella in another love scene.
It was just hitting a guy, and then they kicked him a little while.
I don't think Carmella carries those episodes, and I think when she's used in a limited capacity like she was last night, and, you know, and she played that scene at the end very well when Meadow's telling her, when I'm getting married, and he's out in the pool. With his big gut sitting there on the float.
Splashing water.
I don't know. I guess I just liked it more than I've liked episodes in the past. I hated the ones where Carmella was in the love scene.
Yeah.
I even put up with that because I think he's going somewhere with it.
Right.
And, you know, I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. But come on. You disappoint me, dude. You got him in the office with Melfi, and he's letting some stuff go. And that's the best. I mean,
and I hate the Melfi scenes normally. I don't know why I didn't. That made me laugh.
5 years, and that's the best you can come up with? Oh, my God. My mother. I was afraid to tell him about my mother. And Tony, God. Hey, Mike, I would have laughed because he was comical if it wasn't James Gandolfini.
Right.
If it wasn't like some guy do. I'm mad at him the same way I was mad at De Niro when I first saw Analyze This.
You don't like it being wimpy. You like your gangster stuff.
You know what? I don't even mind the wimpy.
Oh, he's a creeper.
I don't even mind the wimpy stuff. De Niro didn't do it well in Analyze This. But in this one, it's just so soap opera.
Well, I agree that overall the show's gone soap opera. We need more mafia stuff.
More action.
I want to see more mafia stuff. But I just thought... you know, I laughed more at that Sopranos than I've laughed at a lot of them. You know,
well, there's a lot of good parts.
Yeah, yeah, really. That security guard
moment.
My God,
that was great. Beyond, that's like in your all-time 10 Sopranos moments.
Sure, sure, absolutely.
You know, right. He shows up and his head comes up out of that guy's lap,
looking right at him. Hey, and then the fear, you know, right out of the back, because you really felt, you know, what's going to happen?
And that may not be over yet.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, see, now if I'm that kid, though, I say, hey, listen, Meadow, it's been nice knowing you.
Yeah, I'm gone. And now that we're analyzing it, now you go back and I look at that, maybe that's not plausible either. When you go back, why do you propose marriage? You'd probably want to get out of Dodge,
Mm-hmm. I would think so.
Go back to the construction site.
The job my dad got you. My dad, I don't mind Meadow on the show.
No,
I like Meadow.
Yeah.
I like Meadow. I like
AJ.
I like AJ. Who didn't like Meadow? Rob?
Right.
Much of her.
No, a lot of nice Meadow. She's still got.
Rob didn't like Meadow. Rob liked Vito.
That's right, Mike.
Rob. As soon as he saw the episode, Rob immediately wanted to have a new career. He wanted to be a rent-a-cop. He wants to be a security guard real bad. He just wants the overnight shift at construction.
Actually, I set my alarm for 2:45, and I just went to every construction site I could find.
You're killing me with that one.
Mike. So listen, here's a. I know what Mike did this weekend. I had to do this at my kid's school, and I did something recently for the Fuentes, for the Arturo Fuente Cigar Company, a charity auction.
Charity auctions are DJs do a lot of charity auctions. You get asked a lot to do a lot of these things, and I did one last night, and it was a last minute. I think I was a last minute replacement. Their number one guy wasn't going to be there. And Howie Long was there from Fox NFL Sunday, right. And he was there. And
Howard has been on the show before.
I said I saw hello, Howard. He didn't remember me. But the thing was, I get to this thing, and it's for the USO and a very good cause. Yeah. And I was glad to do it. I was glad to help him out at the last minute. But I walk in, and everybody is coming up to me and saying, "Hey, glad you could help us out, man. Terry Bradshaw did the best job last year." If I have one more person say that to me, and with every person.
Who are ye?
Yeah, who are ye?
Where's Terry Bradshaw?
You know, if you don't feel like a Muppet when you're up there with one of these things, and another person would come and go, "Hey, we're really glad you're helping us out. Boy, last year did Terry Bradshaw do a job. He had more fun. He had this crowd going nuts." And then they give me the auction sheet.
Mm-hmm.
And they give me the numbers. What you do normally with an auction, you have a starting bid, and then they show you what you did last year. And I'm looking at these numbers that Terry Bradshaw
did. But, Mike, it was Terry Bradshaw.
They're Hall of Fame football player.
For ye.
Come on now. And, it was obvious from the minute I got up there that, the attitude. You know, maybe I'm being paranoid, but I'm looking out at the sea of faces, and those faces are looking up at me, and you know what they're saying to me?
You're not.
Where's Terry Bradshaw?
Now, how come Howard Long, who was there, how come Howard Long, who is definitely not a stranger to being in front of people, how come they didn't corral him?
I don't think he wanted to do it, and I think that wasn't what he was there for. He was there for, to just be there, and he was, and he stayed. He stayed even during my, my limping through this auction.
Plus, he heard what a great job Bradshaw did last year.
Yeah, exactly. And at one point, I don't know exactly what was said, but I said, "Hey, I'm not Terry Bradshaw." And, I think somebody was in the back and went, "I'll say," and then the little laughter, and I'm like, and I really just want to, I really wanted to stop the whole thing, put the microphone down, and then quote his vodka,
tell him to get down.
I really wanted to tell him all to get down.
Hey, Terry Bradshaw, get back on your broom.
But but it was one of those deals where I just, before you even start, it's going to be like that, and I'm sitting there going, "Oh, please. Please, no, get me away."
And you made it through the night.
I made it through.
You sold all the junk, right?
But it was on the throes of a very difficult weekend when I got up on set because I was ill. I was feeling very, very sick most of the weekend, and that was.
Why wasn't I not alerted immediately?
I was sick. I went to bed Saturday night. I think I went to bed at 6:45.
I didn't get up until like 6 in the morning.
I had my turban on all weekend.
Call me if his condition worsens.
And if you got better, and you are better, of course, that pleases me greatly.
I don't know if my illness was a result of a little too much to drink.
Hey, everybody, can I just have 1 second?
Yes.
When Mike says, you know how sometimes when Mike says, when he's drunk, but he says festive, because he only say, I got
right,
drunk.
Right.
When Mike says illness, he means he has the clap.
It's terrible.
You got it.
Yeah,
sorry. You got it.
That's right. VD's for everybody.
You don't remember this on TV, do you?
No, I don't. We had this on Friday with Joe in the movies. And
you remember watching it, right?
Late 60s, early 70s, I think.
They ran the hell out of this thing.
VD.
You know, maybe in some recess of my mind I remember it, but not consciously.
I mean, because it was so noticeable.
Right.
You know, it's like when because I remember when it came out, I'm like, oh, they're talking about VD.
So your clap got better.
No, I was still in the throes of feeling nauseous on Sunday night. I mean, I really wasn't feeling that well, so that added to it. And the reason I felt nauseous is because I made eggs the way Rob said.
Oh.
Now, Rob, the thing is, when I ate these eggs, I cooked them up on Saturday morning.
Yeah.
And as soon as I ate them, I felt, you know that feeling when you feel as though something's in your sternum, something's right there. And
how many did you eat?
I ate 12.
Well, that's too many.
No, I ate 3.
That should be fine.
I ate 3.
Did you make them the way that Rob said off the internet?
All right, let me see if I got it right.
All right, Mike, tell us what you did.
Internet eggs.
All right, well, they were underdone.
Oh, Mike, tell us what you did.
Not runny, they were just, okay.
What did you do?
All right, I put them, I got the water.
Right.
I put the eggs in the water with a covering them by an inch.
Okay, good.
I turned the water up to a boil.
Right.
When it came to the boil, I covered them for 17 minutes.
Right, and you turned off the heat, right?
Yes. I turned the heat off, and then I as soon as the 17 minutes was up, I put them in ice water.
That's
and then I ran them under warm water.
That's
and
exactly
I think what,
right.
I may, the only one part of that I may not have done, I may have been a little eager to eat them, so I don't think I gave them the 17 minutes. It might have been a little short of that. Like
well, then
maybe,
you know what? You
maybe,
probably.
Maybe 10.
Then they're terribly undercooked.
So they were undercooked.
Oh.
Can you get, but I mean, you can have your eggs runny. I mean, I didn't understand. But I was burping. I was making egg burps.
I thought you didn't like slimy, sloppy eggs.
I was making egg burps all
day.
Oh. Huh. All day until the end of the day, and I was out at the horse race, so I flew down to the Kentucky Derby.
Of course.
I was out at the Gold Cup horse race, and I was sitting there, and maybe I got too much sun, but it was a combination of this, and I had the same kind of feeling that you get when you feel seasick.
Mm. Wow.
That's how I felt at the end of the day.
Bradshaw was never affected by the day.
But it was an interesting weekend, an awful lot going on, but it ended
17 minutes next time.
Yes, next time 17 minutes. Maybe they were bad eggs.
Yeah, probably.
It said May 7th. So I think eggs are good till May 7th.
Howie Long's on the phone. He says Terry Bradshaw made those last year at that auction.
I'm still afraid of Howie Long.
And everybody loved them.
I was, when I shook Howie's hand before the auction, mm-hmm. I said, hey, how you doing, Howie? And, you know, he gave me that kind of look that just was like, Howie's a very imposing man when you see him in person.
Did you remind him of the show? I mean, his wife listens to our show. I don't know if he's been on, but, you know, I would imagine he probably...
I don't know why he got offended. When I shook his hand, I went, hey, fag. And
he doesn't like that.
Yeah, he didn't seem to take kindly to it.
Hey, you know? I dare Howie Long to call in today. I would double dare.
You know, that would embarrass me further because then he'd give like a review of my performance.
If his wife is listening now, please have your microphone shy husband call. And make sure you tell Howard Long, former Oakland Raider great, Mike just called him a fag.
Thanks for throwing me under the bus with that one, boy. No, it was very nice to see Howie, and very nice to perform for him.
How did he seem to like your show?
I didn't even look at him when I was doing the auction, because I was really,
now, were you
know.
Cutting, were you,
I was cutting up. I went
you
through
cutting
the,
up?
I went through the levels. I went through the levels of, I went for the comedy approach, which had just killed him at my kids' school's auction. Mm-hmm. You know.
Have a sample?
Huh?
Give us a sample.
No, you can't have a sample.
No, come on, give us a sample. What's something?
No.
What's something? When you were laying it on at this charity auction, what was one of the funny things you said? What was some of your
I don't remember what
come
I
on.
Said.
You must have. Did you do your voices?
What I said was I started out with a sheep joke. The sheep about that sheep that had all the wool on it.
Hey, 600
pounds worth. It was. I said that sheep must have been grazing in Barry Bonds' yard.
That normally kills.
Shut up. Hey, that's a funny joke.
That's right.
Request denied.
When you're doing an auction, you cajole and you kind of make fun of people. Say, hey, we can do better than that. You kind of poke fun and then you go from that level, because that's not working, people aren't responding to that, where you're trying to, browbeat them into it,
right?
You go to the ticker approach, the heartstrings approach. That didn't, I guess I did okay. A couple of people walked up to me and said, that was fine.
Well, there you go.
I just want to do better next time.
Did the auction make as much this year as it did last year?
I don't think so.
Ooh.
I'd say...
And I think it was my fault.
You would cancel that invite back next year, then.
Yeah, well, here's the deal. This is, for all you junior entertainers out there, never follow, a Hall of Fame quarterback.
Right.
If you're a disc jockey.
I can't tell you, one time I was doing a DJ hop.
Mm-hmm.
We had to do back a record hop, for some kid's birthday party.
Right.
And I got there, and I thought I was on top of it. I mean, I was playing the top hits of the day.
Sure.
Tiffany and Milli Vanilli.
Good, right.
And they said to me... Bubba Smith was at the party last year. He was a much better DJ than you were.
Wow.
He was a much better DJ.
Wow, that's very difficult.
Kidding.
You didn't go with the thing I suggested last year, which was you should have done the whole thing as Bob Hope, since it was a USO auction.
Yeah, that would have worked.
You go up there with a golf club?
That room.
Did you cuss at all? Did you use any profanity?
No.
Not even good-natured. Not even
I'll give you a point. Is the guy?
Son of a bitch.
At one point, I'm auctioning off the. I didn't say no.
I've said that at auction before.
It's the room. So at one point, the guy asked me about the wine that I'm auctioning off, and the guy had already read it. The guy that donated the wine had already done this description of it, and so I look at the guy. And you got to get the crickets ready, right? Because get real serious, because this is exactly what happened.
Okay.
All right. So the guy looks at me and goes, "Can you tell me what are those bottles of wine again?" And I said, "Sir, I can't read the labels. I'm just a disc jockey." And he got mad.
Ooh.
He got angry.
Well,
I mean, literally, he's looking. He gave me one of the head shakes where he just goes, "Okay." And then I had to get the guy that, it was really that kind of thing.
Wow.
I just hope you didn't ruin things with Howard.
We have
Howard Long on the show a couple of times.
I may be overblowing my poor performance. It was not that bad. You know what it was? It was fine. It was just fine.
Uh-huh.
But, as I told you in the office upstairs, I knew it going in, and I didn't know until I got there. And I knew going in that it was going to be, whenever anybody says to you, hey, the guy that did it last year... just run. Just run. Just say you got the flu and run out.
Rob had to do an appearance. I think it was Advanced Auto Parts. I don't know. Wherever it was, he was doing an appearance.
Mm-hmm.
And they told him and said, you're great. But the guy who was here last week, you ever heard of a guy named Roman Gabriel?
He was fantastic.
Said, boy, was he great.
He was great.
He kicked ass. We have to break. Listen. Hey, today, besides the trip to Los Angeles on the show, a name from the past. A name from the past.
Mm.
We've gone through some of our old files. Regretfully, Mr. Zodiac is dead.
Mr. Zodiac regretfully has passed.
Mm. Yeah. We were going to try to have him on the... Remember that guy? You're looking well.
You're looking well, and now he can do that from heaven.
He's very dead. However,
no, he's in heaven.
Let me just give you a brief tip as to who's going to be on the show in a couple of minutes here. Hold on a second. Not next, but sometime after that.
Yeah, okay, old music fans.
Then the guy with the Tron suit. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
I think you're all set, so just go clean the pipes and it's a go. Huh? Clean the pipes. What do you mean, clean the pipes? You choke the chicken before any big date, don't you? Tell me you spank the monkey before any big date. Oh, my God, he doesn't flog the dolphin before a big date. Are you crazy? That's like going out there with a loaded gun. Of course that's why you're nervous. Holy shit. I've been going out with a loaded gun.
The Don and Mike Show.
Hello.
You've
can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Uh-oh. Sounds like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
They are the Dean's Peanuts, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Yeah, we try.
Oh, yeah.
Mike, today we have some great news.
What's that?
Well, my prayers are answered. I dedicate this song. Paul McCartney.
Let me just say, a lot of things I pray for in my life. The safety,
I know, you're a religious man.
Safety of my family,
yes.
Of my friends, a quick and speedy end to the war in Iraq.
Right.
And then I think probably number four on my list has been Roy Horn.
You're praying for him to do well.
Yes, and...
I hope you have good news.
And Mike, Roy Horn, you know what? I need the religious music, because this has to be...
That would be appropriate.
This has to be a gift from the J-Man.
Miracle, I think.
Or the G-Man.
Okay. God or Jesus.
Roy Horn speaks.
Yes.
That's the bulletin.
That's a miracle right there.
And he will speak during an upcoming 90-minute NBC special. He will tell the story of being eaten alive by the tiger to Maria Shriver.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
So anyway, let me just
I thought
say,
he was telling that story to Vito.
For those of you who think... Oh, he knows that story. You know what? He might like Vito to tell that story to him, I think.
Sure.
He's probably read that story.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
He probably likes having it read to him.
I think so.
I think so.
Or he likes reading it himself.
Well, then he'd be like, who was that field goal kicker?
the guy
for the New Orleans Saints.
That was alleged.
I know it was alleged, but it's so long ago we could say his name now if I could remember his.
Morton Anderson.
Right, yeah, he's still in the league with Kansas City.
Yeah, absolutely. Very flexible.
He sure is.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, that's it. Roy Horn is speaking, so.
What a day. What a joy.
There's your
what
miracle.
A joyous day.
Let me just say thank you, God.
Gift from
if
God.
He's speaking, can performing be just around the corner?
And now to,
I think so.
Now to lesser items. Although, I'm going to go with the button first.
No.
Yes, I am, Rob.
Really?
Yes, I am, because I think it will be a conversation starter on this show. I really do. Mike, and now let me ask this question not only of Mike, but of our listeners in the South.
Hmm.
Where's our Southern music? Where's that Dixie music? Don't we have like... Because this is a Southern phenomenon coming out of the state of Louisiana. And then I'll get to the other stuff. Okay, here it is. Nope, wrong one. It says Dixie on it. This is my brother's music.
It's still Clampett-like.
Yeah, very mountain music.
But it's not political.
While Rob's looking, I'll wait for it. Anyway, we like Louisiana. We like Alabama. We like Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
We like the Carolinas, all of these states, some of which we broadcast to. Oh, thank you, Rob. Well, they're trying to stop something, Mike, which is happening throughout the Mid-South.
What are they trying to stop?
It's a blood sport that's called hog-dogging.
Hog-dogging.
Hog-dogging is where one very strong pig fights one very strong dog to the death.
Wow. Oh, my God.
Now, at least one state legislator, I think from Louisiana, is trying to outlaw what they're calling a violent sport.
No. I can't imagine why they'd call it violent.
Hog-dogging.
Hog-dogging.
Let me see. Representative Warren Tritch says his motivation is it's cruel and damned well sadistic. He also says that there are thousands of people in the South who love hog-dogging, and they, quote, have a hillbilly attitude.
That surprises me. I can't imagine why that would be popular with hillbillies.
Now, Jimmy Young, who's a guy who lives in Louisiana, and you'd be amazed.
Jimmy Young!
You'd be amazed how many guys are named J.Young in the phone book in Louisiana.
Right.
We spent about 2 hours today calling them, asking the whole if they're the hog-dogging guy.
Jimmy Young!
We can't find Jimmy Young, but Jimmy Young says, this event is not brutal. It is useful. For you see, the hogs cause him and his fellow farmers and not a property damage.
Oh.
So the event is an occasion where their trained dogs can help terminate the problem of the wild pigs.
But I thought the... So basically, the pigs always lose.
They're wild pigs.
Well, you know, I was.
Oh, are they wild pigs?
Yeah,
they are. And here's where I'm wondering if anybody's been to this.
I bet we'll have people in our audience that have seen Hog Dog. And
let's say you get a wild pig.
Right.
Well, what if you had a
dog? I think of a wild pig as like a boar.
Yeah, they're mean.
Yeah, and let's say you get one of those animals, and you get like a big German Shepherd.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like a killer dog.
Right.
You get a Rottweiler.
Right.
Who would win, the pig or the dog?
Well, I mean, I wonder if
my money would be on the dog, depending on what dog and what pig. But generally speaking, I'll take dog over pig.
Well, it's obviously a brutal
and it's
sport.
Deadly. Before I was married, mm-hmm. sexually, same thing. When I was out dating,
mm-hmm. You'd rather take a dog than a pig.
Dog over pig.
Very good. I think really, if they eat the hog afterwards,
mm-hmm.
you know, I mean, but. If the dog dies, that's terrible.
Yeah, that'd be awful.
That's probably kind of brutal anyway. It's like cockfighting.
Yeah, exactly, which is being outlawed. Turn to this.
Pig versus dog.
Tape of a hog dog going in now. Oh,
well, we know who's going to win that one.
And, of course, here we go. Eric, Don and Mike show. Eric.
Don, videotapes of that is being sold in Baltimore at the flea market.
Don, videotapes of that is being sold.
Mm-hmm. At the flea market.
Mm-hmm.
At the flea market.
Is it called hog dogging?
Yeah, exactly.
Hog dogging.
Videotapes of that is being sold.
Have ye seen the video?
Ye have bought quite a number of the videos.
You have. And
yeah.
And who wins more, the pig or the dog?
Well, the dog wins because what they don't tell you is when the dog corners the pig,
mm-hmm.
guys usually go up to him and stab him a couple of times with a buck knife.
Oh, well, now that's not a fair fight then.
Exactly.
How are the pigs ever supposed to win?
Exactly. As soon as the pigs turn to fight with the dogs, they run up to him and they're like, jab the pigs a couple of times.
I can't believe, you know, well, I'm sorry. I got to think that on some level there's a Don King that's running this who would allow that.
I would think if they can't outlaw it, the least they could do is regulate it so it's fair.
Yeah, and of course it all leads to ham.
Hello, Keith.
And is
hey, how you doing?
Keith, you're on the air. Hi.
I got buddies in Georgia. They go hog hunting. They take five bulldogs out and they let them run loose in the field until they pin a pig. And then the dogs tear the pig apart. They give $200 a pig to get it off a farmer's land.
Wow.
So
the pigs cause that much trouble.
So they're like extermination. But what about just for fun with these videotapes?
Well, I mean, these guys in the backwoods, you know, when they're not out doing this like for a living, they do put, that's how they train their dogs. They get like piglets and they train the dogs to tear the piglets apart. So when they get out,
oh my wild, God, they eat pigs.
So when they get,
this is the United States we're talking about.
Sure. Yeah, Georgia, North Georgia.
Oh, yeah.
North Georgia.
North Georgia, yeah. North Georgia,
not South Georgia.
Not to be confused with Baghdad. Hello, Todd.
Yeah.
Todd, hi, Todd.
It's another guy, yeah.
Yeah. How are ye?
Not too bad. This is Cowboy Todd.
Disqualified. Todd. You were there on the air, but you gave yourself a nickname.
It's going to be hard to find an expert who doesn't have a nickname.
Yeah, yeah, they just got to keep them to themselves. Yeah.
Don and Mike show. Hello. Dave?
Yeah, hey. Don and Mike, I've seen it. I've done it. A German Shepherd would probably last about 10 seconds before it was dead.
Really?
With a wild pig?
Yeah. Hang on a second. I'm going to take that. There we go. Although... the German Shepherds are aggressive. I think that's what ended up killing it, is because they don't know how to, like, bob and weave. They would just go in and that.
Well, then what dog?
Tusks are so sharp.
Dave, in your estimation, what dog has a chance against a wild pig?
Well, here's what we did it with. Believe it or not, we used, and it was the best dog I've ever used, it was a rat terrier. A little tiny rat terrier, about probably twice the size or 2.5 times the size of a chihuahua.
And
the thing is just so lightning fast. Here's what the guy did that I went with. The dog is so lightning fast, it gets in there and it nips it and the pig turns and the pig is so intent on trying to kill that dog that the guy comes up from behind it and pulls out his .44 mag and just pops it right in the head, and the pig didn't even know the guy was standing there.
Wouldn't it save a lot of...
Am I the only one who's used it? I just got to say, Am I the only one that's slightly turned on?
Yes. Yes, you are.
Oh, my God.
Now,
these are erotic tapes. Baby.
The video I saw, they did the same thing with bigger dogs, but they were wiry and fast dogs, and they came up with a Bowie knife and just stabbed it. You know, and the guy would come up and just stabbed it and then backed off, and then
well,
the dog...
Okay, you know an awful lot about it. Why were you involved in it? Why? How did you get into it?
I ate the meat. I eat my pigs. When I don't go out and just sport hunt them and then leave them. But the farmers will let you on there gladly because they just destroy. We're out here in California by Napa, and they absolutely destroy the vineyards. It looks like a rototiller goes through in one night, and it'll destroy about a 200-square-foot area.
So you might as well, you know, get rid of the pigs, but let's torture them for a little bit before
yeah,
you
know,
go.
You know what? You know what? The stabbing thing I'd have a hard time with.
Yeah, but not the 44 Magnum.
Well, yeah, you just come up and pop. I know I shot mine with a 30-06. Uh-huh. He was actually running.
Hold on a second, Farmer John.
Close range.
You have a problem with stabbing, but you had no problem pulling out a handgun and shooting the pig.
Well, here's why I don't. Because I'm, number one, if someone said, let's go out and kill some pigs and leave them lay, I wouldn't be involved. But if someone said, hey, do you want to get some pigs?
Leave them lay.
That's how you do it.
But hold on.
So, yeah, I filled my
pig. Yeah, but I mean, why do you, I mean, if you catch the pig and you slaughter the pig,
yeah.
You know, and but what's the deal with the dog thing?
Yeah, why risk?
Well, because the pig, if the pig sees you, it will... I've hunted bear, and I've killed bear, and I've killed pig, and I never felt so intimidated until I went face-to-face with a hog. Because they are lightning fast, and they will kill you. And a bear just wants to get away.
Why don't you just walk in a room with this pig and, like, point your gun at him and shoot him?
In the room with it?
Walk in the barn,
the
wherever you've got
wherever.
The field. You know,
well, no, these are wild boars. These
yeah,
are
but
like,
they, but they're wild.
Hogs mixed with,
Hold on. They're wild. We're talking about something where obviously the pig is caught. Obviously, it's put in a pen.
No.
Well, with the hog dogging.
Oh, with the hog dogging.
Yeah.
I see what you're saying.
Because that's like cockfighting.
And then the guys will do that as training their dogs.
How many,
you really don't need to do that. They have their reasons, and I'm not going to say they're wrong for doing that.
No, you know, I had
decision,
a guy.
But I'm not comfortable.
I had a good friend of mine. I had a really good friend of mine. And, you know, here's the deal with this. I had a good friend of mine that was a hunter. It was his passion. He used to like it. And he was the most honest hunter I ever met. I said, why do you hunt? He said, I like to kill things. And he was honest. And I think that, you know, that's why a lot of these people say, hey, you're out there, you know, and it's you're breathing the air and experiencing. Come on. It's the thrill of the kill. It's the
thrill.
You know
what? I was raised that. My dad, when we were kids, my dad used to wake us up on Saturdays and say, come on, boys. And we'd go out back and we'd line up our rabbits and we'd butcher our own rabbits and eat our rabbits. We'd eat our chickens. That was the way I was raised. So then when I got...
Boy, Beaver, you and Wally must have had the best time growing up. Me, I was just getting on my Stingray bicycle with the banana seat and the big gigantic handlebars, wanting to go down and get a Good Humor ice cream.
Well, there's
I did that, too. I did that. I used to make the jumps.
In between kills.
I had time.
How many dogs have you seen go down, be maimed or killed fighting with hogs?
On video, I've seen quite a few. In real life, I haven't seen any. But that carrier we used, he did get laid out, but he lived.
That's my question. Why put the dogs through that? It just seems like if the hogs are a pest, just kill the hogs, I guess.
Try and stop that dog.
Okay,
He loves every minute of it.
Okay, last question then. When you get past all of that, protecting your wine fields or whatever it is that you're saying.
Right.
Why you got it on a videotape and why are you watching it on video?
Well, because it's like a how-to thing, you know, and you want to, and I was glad I did.
I don't buy that.
I didn't realize.
I do not buy that. I've always said that about pornography.
If I was going to get in that position, you don't get in that position unless you have at least a tree you can scurry up by you. If that pig decides to turn away from the dog.
How many times have you watched the hog versus pig, the pig versus dog video? How many times?
I think I've seen two, and that was enough.
He's an honest. You know, I'll give you credit for being honest about it, but it's kind of sadistic, don't you think?
Absolutely. I don't get involved.
Tiptoeing around.
It's horrible. And what would you say to your brothers in Louisiana who are. The legislature wants to get rid of this awful, this fantastic American pastime.
You know what? that, I'm not going to get involved in the political thing. My view is if they make it illegal, then I won't do it anymore.
But as long as it's legal in California to have dogs fight against pigs, you'll be there?
Well, no. If someone said, "Hey, do you want to go see some hog dogging?" Me personally, no. I don't want to see that. I know what it's about.
Now, see, now you're lying. Hold on. Yeah. Now you're lying because you've spoken about this for 15 minutes with a lot of passion.
No, I told you what I did. And
come on, step strong to the microphone. Dude, I'm not saying like that you get turned on by this, although I think you might be in some recess of your mind.
Sure.
But you enjoy watching it. Listen, I want to tell you something. Yeah, I'm repulsed by this. I want to see a videotape of it.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see the videotape.
Well, you can rent them at any hunting store.
Where do I go? I've not seen that section yet in my Blockbuster for pig versus dog.
Right. Right.
Oh no! You go to a hunting store that's
hunting store.
Yeah, and make sure you don't go to a hunting store. You'll need to go to a hunting store.
That's right. Absolutely.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Take care, you guys.
All right. Goodbye.
Bye.
Good day to you, sir.
Well, he was very forthright.
Fascinating
with all that.
Good day.
Jeez.
And his dad would get him up, and they'd go kill their rabbits and
hog dogging.
And
sure.
Off on the bike.
Hog dogging.
Hog dogging.
Is it dog? It's hog
dogging.
Hog dogging.
Hog dogging.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
I think the point that we really brought up like three different times, that guy. You got a problem like with a hog that's screwing up your farm or something. You go out and get a rifle with a sight with a scope on it. And you shoot the thing.
Or you do what Bill Murray did. You know, you make all those traps in the ground.
Yeah, put water down there
for the crazy goat.
I think about 10,000 gallons of water ought to do it.
Please, no wagering.
Well, you get your dog out there.
Strange world, man.
Okay, here's Mike. And Mike, these calls now are from all over the country, not just the South. The last guy's California. Here's Mike in Delaware. Mike.
Yeah, man, they do this out on the Eastern Shore over, you know where Willard's is?
Oh, I do. Sad to say, yes, I do. I know where Willard's is.
About a town?
Yeah.
See, last year they had a big event right after pumpkin chunking, like that time of year.
Mm-hmm. Don't tell me that they do hog dogging at the same time as they do pumpkin chunking.
Yeah, last year was cool because Terry Bradshaw came out, man. It was great.
Get out
hey,
of here.
That's great.
Get
that worked.
Here.
You got us.
Very nice.
Get out of here. That's fun. Because you know the pumpkin chunking up there. I know what he's talking about there. That's
is where that where they launch the pumpkins?
That's where like people actually build like Roman
catapults.
I'd love
to go see that.
To send the pumpkins as far as.
I bet you meet the nicest people there.
Yeah.
You know.
I bet you meet nicer people there. You do it a hog dog.
You know what? I think you'd look at that. I think I'd look at that out of curiosity and then turn away.
Yeah.
I really think
yeah,
it's
one more call
nice.
And we got a break. Hello, Don and Mike Show. Josh, here's Josh in Kansas. Josh.
Hey, that guy before the last was an idiot and a liar. It's a big underground thing down around the South, and it's derived from a bunch of drunk slack jaw yokels in around Tennessee and stuff who breed dogs it's almost like rodent control, and they breed these dogs to go out and kill these pigs. And I hunt pigs down in Oklahoma and stuff, blondes, brunettes, all that kind of
stuff. That's a cheery gig.
Blondes, brunettes. He's making a pig joke.
Yeah.
But it's derived from all that, and they train their dogs, and then they started betting.
Okay. God.
What another kind of hog dogging mentality. There it was.
Hey, hold on a second.
They derived from the pig.
Fuck, were they? Jeff Foxworthy, check it in. Uh-huh. Hello, Willie.
Yeah.
This can't be right. Willie.
Willie? Right.
Willie from Arkansas. Willie.
Yes, sir.
You're on the air. Turn your radio down, Willie.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Willie from Arkansas.
Yes, yeah. Willie from Arkansas. How you doing?
Yes, Willie.
What can we do for you, William?
Okay. The hogs and dogs were not really a popular thing as much as cockfights were, okay? They started the hogs and dogs.
Okay, interesting. When somebody says okay like that, okay. What they're doing is they're making sure that we're speaking the same language.
Yeah, we understand you. Hogs and dogs are like cockfights. Yes, we understand.
Hogs are not as much as derived from the training.
Yes, William, you were
okay.
saying.
Okay.
William?
William.
All right, go ahead, William.
Okay, you ready?
Yes. Born ready, William.
We are ready to hear the explanation of the hog dogging.
Okay, the hog dogging is...
They trained the best dogs they could, which was Rottweilers and German Shepherds.
Right. All right. Okay. Hog Doggin, hold on. I want to read. Just for the sake of argument, I will repeat your last one. Hog Doggin is they train the best dogs.
That's right.
Yes.
What does that sentence mean, sir?
They train the best dogs.
All right. Okay.
They train the
hog dog it is. They train the best dogs.
They train dogs to go against pigs. Number one.
That now I understood that one. They train dogs to go against pigs.
Yes, they do. Uh-huh. Pigs are very indefensive. They're very smart animals.
Pigs are very.
They're not like.
Hold just one. I'm writing it down.
Yeah.
Pigs are very indefensive. Now, what is indefensive?
Now, do you like to be called William or Willie?
Willie. Okay.
All right, go ahead, Willie.
Okay, I got you.
All right, answer Mike's question, please.
What is it, define the word indefensive?
Animals that cannot defend themselves. Basically, but they're very smart animals. But if they go against a very intensive dog, then they're not going to be able to defend themselves. That's my definition of indefensive.
Indefensive. Okay.
Which is a hell of a word, yeah, I know.
That's a 25-cent word, Willie.
Okay, I know. It's not a $100 word, but it's a 25-cent
word. No, it's not. So, Willie, do you watch the videotapes?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I have seen them. Basically, they're pretty sad.
Have you heard the rumor that if you watch those videotapes over a long period of time, eventually they will suck all of the brain juice out of you?
That could probably happen.
Hey, Willie. Yeah. Whoa, no. Little Willie.
Little Willie won't go home.
Won't go home.
All right.
Please go home, Willie.
All right.
Thank you for calling from Arkansas.
All right.
Can we immediately turn the power off to Arkansas?
Wait a minute.
Get out of here. Can we just turn off the
power? Wait a minute. They are very indefensive to the breed derived from the PETA.
I told you that's a lead, not a button.
Okay.
How can you possibly on this show?
That is a good call on that one. Absolutely.
Lots of other funny stuff. Do you care the movies? What was number one? Mean Girls was number one,
mm-hmm.
right?
Tina Fey's movie.
That's right. Mean Girls number one. Yeah. Number two, Denzel, Man on Fire. Then 13 Going on 30, Laws of Attraction. Yuck. Godsend. Yuck. Envy. I'm surprised Envy didn't do better. That's Jack Black and what's his name?
And Ben Stiller.
Mm-hmm. Ben Stiller.
Yeah.
Then Kill Bill, Punisher, Home on the Range, and Scooby-Doo.
Where did Hog Doggin finish?
Hog Doggin, Mike, that's you can't get it at Blockbuster.
Hey, you got to go to the hunting store.
And This is just, I know we're up on a break, so let me just mention this very quick. I'll save all this other stuff for tomorrow. I don't understand this. ABC is the worst television network.
Yep.
They're worse than Fox, mm-hmm. okay? Now, when people talk about the networks, they used to say the big three. Now, when they say the big three, they mean CBS, NBC, and Fox.
Right.
ABC's not even considered one of the big three. Mm-hmm. ABC is maybe even now getting smaller than the WB
mm-hmm.
and UPN.
I understand they're changing. They're not going to call him Peter Jennings anymore. They're calling him Pete Jennings.
Oh,
that'll be good.
So what does ABC do? Because they're having all these problems.
Right.
Like none of their shows get watched by anybody.
Yeah.
And, hey, listen, what a crime that is. Because if you've not discovered the magic that's George Lopez. Let me say TGIF in my day. TGI whatever I day I TiVo it.
I couldn't find all the Disney references in the episode this week, so I need to talk to you about that. I need the help so I can win the trip.
Why all the attention to the Friends finale when Drew Carey's show is ending?
There you go. This is exactly what I'm talking about.
Ah.
Now, didn't you think, like me, that the Drew Carey show was canceled?
I thought it was off the air.
I thought it was gone years ago.
Right, his show was... Now, the sitcom was done, and then he did the other show with the improv...
Whose line is it anyway?
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, as it turns out, and this is why ABC is the worst network. I mean, ABC...
This is funny.
ABC really is worse than Westwood One. I mean, we laugh about our radio network, but listen to this. What ABC has decided. They canceled the show in 2001. Mm-hmm. They have space to fill now. What they did was they fired all the producers on the show.
On the Drew Carey show.
Yes. They fired all of the executives at ABC that had green-lighted the show.
Mm-hmm.
And now what they've said is, you know, we got some time, and contractually we are paying you. So Drew Carey has filmed the last season of the Drew Carey show, which will start running soon. And for most sitcoms,
mm-hmm.
They use three cameras.
Right.
Something that was originated by Desi Arnaz.
Right.
Three cameras, three shots, and a live audience. For the Drew Carey show, because they have no budget and they have no producer and they got no talent, they got
One camera.
One camera?
And no studio audience.
So is it going to be a laugh track?
Yeah, it's going to be... All laugh tracks. ABC has had these shows for about 8 months.
They're already in the can.
Yeah, they didn't even bother putting it on this season. They would put new episodes on June 2nd. The network will show two first-run episodes a week during this summer to burn off all of these shows. So they asked Drew Carey about this. They, come on, your show is canceled. Then they come back and they film like the last six episodes because they...
The skeleton crew?
Because they owe you money. And Drew Carey says, and why would he say that? He says, I have nothing bad to say about ABC. And if I was Drew Carey, I wouldn't either.
Hey, that's where the money's coming from.
They put him on TV, and they're making all the excuses for the show, saying that maybe it just ran out of being funny and it got put on too many nights of the week,
yeah.
And that he liked doing crazy contests, like,
right.
So see if you can guess how many mistakes are in this show.
Mm-hmm.
Ratings, let me see the show. And at one time, the show is in the top five.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When it went off the air, the show was ranked number 128.
Don't bite the hand that feeds you.
Of course,
in our case, the hand doesn't have any fingers on it anymore.
they don't have anything to do with him anymore. But they're going to run the shows.
Wow,
just weird on a million different levels.
Just because they're going to run it, and it's
I'd like to see what it looks like.
It's a ninth season. I think a lot of people are going to watch it.
Yeah. I would assume it would be kind of choppy.
Just for that reason, people are going to watch it because it could be awful. And I guess because
you can look for a lot of two shots. I bet.
And also because there are no there's no studio audience and there's not a lot of camera work, there's going to be a lot more of that dumb singing and dancing that he loves.
Oh, the music video.
Because he could do that all in... All
Cleveland the rocks.
You know, for my money, you know how you save that show?
No.
You get Drew Carey and you get... Remember Mimi?
Yeah.
And every week you get her to fight a dog on television.
Yeah.
That's how you say
that. Is
save
smoking.
That. But,
with a different moo-moo on.
Ain't that something? And here's how ABC is trying to promote this. They sent us a thing today about this. You might want to... Robbie? Is it up?
Oh, it's a good doctor.
Oh. Tell him we'll call. Let's hear this. This is Dr. James Capers calling.
Hello. Yes.
Because we're late for the segment.
Little Richard Sondeloy.
Actually, hold on 1 second, Steve. This is the world's cheapest couple.
Oh, that's Wednesday, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll go talk to them.
Yeah, all right.
We'll talk to them Wednesday.
Sorry about that. So many things happening at once.
Sure, well.
So many
lots of plates spinning in here.
Anyway, blah, blah, ABC. Yeah, that's it. Anyway, I don't know why it's going back. I don't know why. Just, you know, they got so much crap they can run over there. Just run anything. Just don't run Drew Carey anymore.
Yeah, I mean, Drew Carey. But you know what? Does it even matter on that network? I don't think anybody cares at this point.
I do not know. And the last thing is that I had to about it. This is also about ABC. I don't remember what online site I read this at today. But something has happened that I had predicted. The New York Giants, when they went to minicamp this weekend, the main story was not Eli Manning and the fact that he demanded to be traded to the Giants.
Eli Manning, who has to be the youngest graduating senior I've ever seen.
The main story with the Giants was everybody hates Jesse Palmer. All the players on the Giants hate him.
Really?
Because
he did that show.
Because he's still on. He's
the Bachelor.
He's still giving away roses every week.
Mm-hmm.
On that. Jesus.
You said that when he came out. I mean, what an idiot move. I mean,
I said that. I imagine that would backfire on him in the dressing room.
Imagine that first day of camp. Hey, pretty boy.
And from what I was, ESPN.com? Or they have an article that gives actual quotes because they got rid of Kerry Collins.
Right.
So now they got Eli Manning. And Eli Manning doesn't know the offense. So you know who's taking the first string snaps with your New York Football Giants? Jesse Palmer,
the male model.
And it's only May, it's minicamp, but he's going up there and he's going down set hut, and like the defensive guys are yelling, hey, are you going to give me a rose? Hey, you going to give me a rose? Hey, bada bada, swing, bada 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 bada.
Man, he had to know. Well, he might have been a dumb jock, so he might not have realized what he was getting into.
Got a break. Dr. James Capers, who wasn't on the phone with Rob.
No.
But we've let the secret out that we'll have the world's cheapest family on the show.
That's exciting.
Dr. James Capers, now his setup today, the Dr. James Capers thing is, he knows where Bin Laden is.
Oh, thank goodness.
He's always got something.
This is a question we'd all wondered about.
He'll answer it for us.
And let's see if he knows what a hog dogging is.
Yeah, I bet he does.
I bet he thinks it's something else.
I think he
yeah, we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
Hey, Larry, there's a syndicated radio show that's huge here in town called the Don and Mike Show. I know they're huge fans of yours. They're coming to town. Could you send us an autographed copy of your book that we can pass on to them?
Wait a minute. You're telling me Don and Mike will read a book about prayer? Give them this message.
Okay.
Tell them both to pray for civility and class.
Ooh.
Hey, it's giving God a job,
word.
Boy.
Thank you.
The Don and Mike Show.
From what I've seen of their records, the only thing they do contribute is mayhem and chaos.
No, I'm chaos and he's mayhem. We're a double act.
The number one radio show in Haiti.
Yeah.
The Don and Mike Show.
They love our ass there. That was a tape of Mark S. Allen with Larry King from Sacramento. We mentioned this on Friday. King's lost. And I think it's game. What is the game tonight against Dallas, Buzz?
This is game 12 tonight.
Game number 12.
Out of 21.
Game number 12, best 21 series.
Right.
Game 12 tonight for your Sacramento Kings.
Go Kings.
So, Dr. James Capers.
Yeah.
Is a guy. I don't know how we started calling this guy years ago. He sent us a press release. One of these guys who could predict the future.
Yes, he is a psychic. And at least that's what he says.
He sounds like Little Richard. And
sounds
also,
very much like Little Richard.
We've noticed when he picks up his phone now, he won't do this because he knows we're going to call him on the air. Uh-huh. But when Rob has called him off the air, and even when we called him on the air the last time, uh-huh. he answers with a fake voice.
He does.
He's trying to dodge the man.
Well, and then he talks with a fake voice. I don't know who the real guy is.
Who's calling, please?
He's a character.
Hold on. He's an astounding mentalist.
Hello.
Hello.
Very strange guy. Just has a funny voice.
Yeah, you got to love
this
guy.
Calling him.
Yeah. Dr. James Capers. Never bothered to ask him what he's a doctor of.
We should.
I believe that today, like I said, his topic is he knows where Bin Laden is.
Mm-hmm.
It's
the doctor in the house.
There he is. Everybody from San Diego, California, here is Dr. James Capers. Hey, Dr. Capers.
Guys, it's a pleasure to be on your show today, and I want you to know, and inquiry minds want to know,
Now, Doc, this is the reason.
Arnie,
what kind of a doctor are you? May I ask?
I have a dual associate degrees in liberal arts and free education, a bachelor's in behavior science, a master's in counseling psychology, also licensed intern MFCC, marriage, family, child counseling, psychotherapist.
Wow.
Cheers, and a PhD, doctorate of philosophy and religious studies.
All of these,
real counseling.
All of these degrees sound like a fabulous resume. What school, if you don't mind me asking?
Oh, sure. I went to Lehigh. I also went to National University, and I also attended the International University.
Wow. Never heard of the International University.
That's
and
it.
I'll tell you what else. You're an astounding mentalist.
You're a telepath, a psychic. What are you, doctor? We're trying to explain to our audience what you are.
I am truly a truly blessed clairvoyant. Matter of fact, on a major television network last year, May 19th, I, in fact, publicly on a huge syndication said where Saddam Hussein was, which was the southern part of Syria and his family. And as you know, guys, 2 months later...
He wasn't in Syria, though.
Listen to me. I said in his family. Listen.
Yeah.
2 months later, when they caught his sons and they went through that brown suitcase, the CIA had released that, in fact, they had just left the southern part of Syria.
Oh, they were in. Okay, they were.
What national?
Uday and Kuse.
What national show were you on where you made this? Because I don't worry about dropping other people's names and hurting our feelings, but I don't recall that.
Because I don't want to do that because then you're going to be mad at me.
No, we wouldn't. We won't be mad.
I'll just give you the initials.
Yeah.
HS.
No. Here's the thing. We got to have a deal. If you're going to be one of the people in our Rolodex, and I know sometimes we go 2 or 3 years between calls.
Too long. But we want exclusivity.
But here's the thing. If we've tagged you, and come on, we've been on you for a long time.
Matter of fact, we're celebrating our 11th year anniversary.
Oh, then don't step out on us with HS.
Don't worry. I won't do him anyway. He asked me to come back after a couple of months after they got the sons, and I didn't do it.
There you go.
All right. So you're telling me that we've had you on this show for 11 years, and all we figured out is that you sound like Little Richard. You go on Howard Stern's show, and you actually predict where they're going to find Osama
Saddam
Hussein.
Hey, I'm I'm making up to you. I'm making it up. I'm giving you an exclusive today.
Oh, okay.
I'm not broadcast on any other station. You guys are getting this exclusive.
All right, now, now this is an exclusive Dr. Capers about Osama bin Laden, correct?
Here we go.
Yes.
We're ready. Lay it on us.
Lay it on us.
Well, I was sleeping in the middle of the night, and when I was in bed, all of a sudden something told me to get up because X marked the spot. And I said, what does that mean? And then all of a sudden I got a vision, and I started seeing Osama bin Laden's face. And then I said, well, isn't he still in Afghanistan? And before I knew it, I began to see everything that happened. And I saw that how he escaped.
You know what's funny?
Through the city.
You call him a carny, and I agree. But right now you're really...
Yeah, yeah.
You're really listening to what he's saying.
Why not?
...of Iran. Then I saw him going across Iran to the Persian Gulf to a place called...
I think he's got a little Michael Jackson in
him. Which is in Saudi Arabia.
I've always thought that.
I found out something that was extremely, extremely abusive. I found out that...
What was that?
Well, this situation had to do with people in high places in Saudi Arabia who already have been fueling... His,
Hey, Doc, so you think he's in Saudi Arabia?
No, yeah, he's in Saudi Arabia. Oh. Latitude 2643 degrees, north longitude 50.10 degrees east.
Oh, wow. You know, it's funny. You're funny, Mike. You're killing me because while he's saying those, he's giving out the longitude and latitude, mm-hmm. Mike's looking at Buzz like... And I
what do you think?
Said,
yeah.
You getting this down? What do you think?
Yeah.
Well, you know what, guys? They laughed at me on HS. And then they came back and tried to get me back on after the CIA made that report. Then I'm telling you, I him. And guess what else I just...
Now, if you're a clairvoyant, do you think he's going to be captured?
Well, he's not going to be captured if they don't go in there in Saudi Arabia and get him.
All right, well, listen, once again, for those at the CIA and the FBI,
yeah.
which, and I know they're not getting along well together, and everybody involved in Iraq... Dr. Capers, again, would you be so kind as to always be giving us the location exactly where Osama bin Laden is, with the longitude and
latitude and longitude.
What did I say? Longitude. The longitude and the other tude.
Yes, the latitude is 26.43 degrees north. Longitude is 50.10 degrees east.
So if you have a GPS, you could actually
find him.
You could find him. You could
drive to him.
You could find him yourself. You could push OnStar and you'll find him.
Now, guys, you know, while we're discussing this, you know, one of the things and why Osama bin Laden has always been ahead of the U.S. government is because he has plants within the government system itself. He's paying off people. There are moles inside our government in high levels.
Really?
Uh-huh.
Yes, sir.
How high?
Not only are there moles there, but it's kind of peculiar for someone... who is, you know, who the CIA and everybody is supposed to be watching all the time.
Hey, Doc.
Elusive.
Doc, who do you think would win in a fight, a pig or a dog?
Well, it depends upon the size of the pig and the size of the dog.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, let's say it's a big wild boar,
right.
And it's a...
Tiny little dog.
Oh, wild boar. Eat the little dog up.
All right, what if it was a wild boar against a big fighting animal like a German Shepherd?
The wild boar would eat the German Shepherd up.
And would you pay for a videotape watching dogs and pigs fighting?
No.
You would not.
Good man.
I like my pigs on the plate, barbecued ribs.
And pleased to be giving us the outlook for Mr. Michael Jackson.
Oh, now, guys, are you sure you want to know about Mike?
Yep.
Absolutely.
Are you sure you want to know about the glove?
Yeah.
I think
you talked about it the last time we talked to you.
Well, now, guys, I want to be honest and sincere.
Yes, of course.
I think that
okay, this is a good time to start.
Is truly a perpetrator, they need to horsewhip him and throw him in jail. I truly believe that.
A perpetrator?
Yeah, I do. I feel
I'm a salt trader.
Is he truly a perpetrator?
I don't know. Is he a pepper trader?
I think that from what the energy that
I'm a pepper, you're a pepper.
Right.
Oh,
nice to be a pepper.
The energy that I got is, oh, Mikey, I'm sorry. Don't get mad at me when you hear this.
Yeah.
But I discern yes.
But he's guilty?
He is a pepper trader?
And remember last time I was on the show, I said no.
You ever met him?
Yes.
What was the circumstances of your meeting Michael Jackson?
Oh, well, you know, I go to a lot of the award shows and things like that. Right. And
it wasn't at a construction site, was it?
No, guys. But anyway, you know what?
Right.
Because it's our 11th anniversary, I decided to give the first 1,000 emailers a free $200 reading.
A free reading.
Ooh, okay.
Only two questions per person.
All right, now it's a free reading for the first 1,000 emails. Doctor, what is your email address?
Oh, that's www.drjamescapers.com.
DrJamesCapers.com.
DrJamesCapers.com. Do you have any other predictions of the futures? Please to give us those.
This coming November, Hillary Clinton will begin her campaign for presidency of the United States of America. So she will start her actual campaign this coming November, organizing things, although it'll be kept under wraps and undercover.
What about Kobe?
Well, the situation with Kobe is that we all know that it was consensual sex. I know because I saw it myself.
Oh, that's right. You saw it. And you, remember that? He told us that he... what else did you tell us about that? You actually saw them having relations, right?
You've got to remember. Like this, guys, you've got to come out to see me demonstrate these things publicly. Because when
I want to take a look at the website, Mike. I just pulled it up, drjamescapers.com. He doesn't look like he sounds.
Oh, great.
No, he really doesn't.
I look kind of handsome.
No, you are a very,
very handsome man.
A very handsome man. I would say you kind of look like...
DeMond Wilson?
I thought I looked like Johnny Mathis.
Yeah, you look a little like Johnny Mathis.
Fat Johnny Mathis.
A young, handsome Johnny Mathis.
I think Al Roker, after he had his stomach stapled.
Oh, guys. I'm sorry, don't mean to cut across you. But you know, have we discussed anything about Prince Charles?
No.
Oh, yes.
No, give.
Charles killing Princess Diana. I had the scoop on that. See, I emailed you that flash, and you know what? I didn't do it on your show.
Rob, did you hear that? He emailed us a flash.
Well, you know, we couldn't open it, Dr. Capers. We tried.
Oh, you couldn't? Okay, well, let me tell you all about it.
All right, go ahead.
Okay. The reason why Prince Charles had to dispose of Princess Diana.
She just wouldn't listen?
No, it was because he was caught in the bed with somebody else by two of his butlers.
Really?
Male or female?
When you say butlers, you mean... Who was it?
It was the plumber.
The plumber.
Again, Dr. Capers.
No. It's on record in the court system in England, and I can verify it. He was caught in bed with a bloke.
Let me point out again that if anybody's listening at the CIA, at the Pentagon, the FBI today, according to Dr. James Capers, get your GPS.
Mm-hmm. Osama bin Laden is in Saudi Arabia.
Longitude is 26.43 north, and latitude is 50.10 east.
That's where he is.
That's where he's at.
Now, what if he goes out for coffee or something? Does that latitude and longitude change?
Well, actually, that is the latitude and longitude to the specific city in which he is in. But if they're, they have agents over there, why don't they surround the city and do some investigation? But, guys, let's get back to Princess Diana.
And Dr. Capers, we're almost out of time. I just have to ask you.
I'm going to die.
Tell me about your most recent relationship with a beautiful woman.
You?
Can you tell me about your most recent relationship with a beautiful woman?
Oh, yes. Matter of fact, that was up in Los Angeles just about, it was for the NAACP Image Award, and it was Tyra Banks, I think. She's a model.
Tyra Banks.
Yes, I've heard of Tyra
Banks. Tyra Banks.
Yeah.
She's beautiful.
She's hot. Tyra, not to be confused with her brother Tybo.
We went out to a party and we just had a nice get together. It was kind of nice.
Oh, good.
So you and Tyra Banks. What did Tyra Banks like about you, Dr. Capers?
Well, it was there not to like about a big hunk.
Bob, 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 Bob. Again, his name?
Dr. James Capers.
And
he will fascinate you.
And the first 1,000 people who email him will get some kind of spam.
And don't forget that they can only ask 2 questions on the website, not more than that. If they ask more than 2, their email will not be responded to.
All right, drjamescapers.com. Hey, listen, don't forget what radio show you belong to. We'll talk to you again soon.
Well, yes, and I won't do HS ever again.
All right, well, thanks. Thank God I hadn't known that. Otherwise, I probably would have committed suicide whenever you were on that.
And he would have predicted that.
Goodbye, doctor.
See you guys later. Bye.
Bye, Dr. Capers. There he goes.
He perpetrates some good predictions.
Good radio.
Doesn't he?
Yeah. On his website, be sure and click on the school so you can see the photograph of him in the turban.
I'm going to go there right now.
It'll please you greatly.
Hey, Mike, hold on. Take a look at either one of these monitors.
Oh,
that's a good one. There he is. Well, hello. All right, let's clear the lines and take some of your phone calls.
Yeah, let's talk to some of these perpetrators.
Here you go, 877-365-3636. Maybe you want to ask us a question. Maybe you want to perpetrate something with us.
Very good.
From America, 877-365-3636. From Canada, 800-636-1067. In Washington, D.C., 202-432-1067. That was Dr. James Capers.
Yes, it was.
We'll take your calls on the rotating random telephone scan. These calls are unscreened. Anybody can call us. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
Your sister, on the other hand, gave herself a lot of options, such as Bowdoin, Holy Cross, Georgetown.
You know that Georgetown is a total reach for me.
Oh, please, they'd be crazy not to want you.
If I can get in there, that means I probably can get into Berkeley.
Over my dead body.
There are more Nobel Prize winners in the San Francisco Bay Area than anywhere on the planet.
Nobel Prize for what? Back in fudge?
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Take this square world and blast off for Hicksville.
Like the Girl Scouts, they have changed. Don and Mike.
Yeah. Thank you, Dude Walker.
Yeah.
Your call's lying straight ahead on the rotating random phone scan. Don't want to make everybody wait. The guy in the Tron suit,
Jay Maynard. Don.
Jay Maynard. We had him on the show 10 days ago. We broke him nationally.
Yes, he's going to be on Jimmy Kimmel.
He is. Mm-hmm. And we'll take it. Robbie, here you go.
Yeah.
Just give him a call while we start the phone scan and see if he's there. And see if he wants. If his plane just landed, we can talk to him in a couple of seconds. Anyway, he's going to be on James Kimmel almost live tonight.
Jay Maynard.
And anyway, got to start on the show, so we'll talk to him about that. Now your calls on the phone scan, and here we go. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hello. This is O.J. McKay, and I like the Monkees.
Thank you. You're a little late on that.
That's somebody who's sticking with the Shannon stuff.
Appreciated that. We didn't play. We got a new old tape of him.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but I'm going to save it for a couple days because even I'm burning on it.
Sure.
Oh, hold on a second.
I can understand that.
Everybody, time out, please. If you're online for the phone scan, we come back to you.
Please.
Because we have him now joining us live from Los Angeles. It was just 10 days ago we discovered him on this show, and now look at him.
The Tron suit wearing phenomenon.
On his way to be on the Jimmy Kimmel Show. And I told Rob to tell him we're not going to bust his balls today.
No.
We're proud of this guy. Here's Jay Maynard. Jay.
Hi, Jay.
Howdy.
Jay, the Tron guy.
Yeah. Jay, your 15 minutes continues, my friend.
Believe me, I'm as surprised about it as you are.
Now, Jay, we read, Buzz, where'd you find that thing on the internet where Jay was talking about getting the MP3 of our show?
You know, I just found a link at, fark.com or something.
Mm-hmm. We're happy to read that you were not offended when you were on our show. We're just having some fun, busting some balls.
Because, you know, we do believe that you are indeed the super nerd. And I think you know that, Jay.
Yep.
But, Jay, can you tell us, and what was the website again? Anyone who didn't see him in his Tron suit, it's,
What is it?
Isn't it in Biblio? Or
what's your website, Jay?
It's, If you do a Google search for Tron costumes, the first
yeah.
hit.
Yeah, that's the easiest way. Just go on Google.
That's
so
right.
You were on our show. Then I think you mentioned that there was someone else that called you for an interview, and then some TV people called you. How did you end up with Jimmy Kimmel Tonight?
They were the TV people that called me, and I watched their show a couple times and decided, well, you know, Jimmy Kimmel's no worse than you two.
Hey, he's funny. You'll have a great time on Jimmy Kimmel's show.
I think so.
And of course, you are going to wear the suit on the show, right?
That's the whole point of it.
Of course, right. And I mean, when you got this all started, Jay, what was your ultimate goal with all this?
This is all blown up well beyond my wildest imaginings.
All I
was setting out to do was show people who might be interested in duplicating the costume how to do it.
Right.
And Jay, when you go out, you know, Mike and I have never been on like a Jimmy Kimmel show, David Letterman. When you go out there, do they put you in a nice place? I mean, do they send a limo for you? Or are you at the airport right now?
No, I'm at the Roosevelt Hotel. In fact, if I look out my room window, I can see Grauman's Chinese Theater right across the street, and the Kodak Theater up a little ways.
Oh, so
I look
got,
up on the hill,
you're right,
the Hollywood side.
Really in Hollywood. Now, when you're on his show tonight, are you going to wear a cup?
Because,
you know, there was
you
that.
No, I think I'm going to leave you guys dangling on that.
Hey, so there you go. Because there was that issue of Jay in the Tron suit that maybe there was a little too much of Mr. Maynard that was showing.
Exactly. Jay, now, your current weight, are you heavier or are you lighter than the pictures that we saw on the Internet? Or are you about the same?
I'm lighter.
You're about 5 pounds lighter?
Good for you.
Have you been dieting in anticipation of your national television exposure?
No, actually, it's good. More that I've had a cold over the past few days.
Yeah, you sound a little under the weather. You do. Yeah.
And so I haven't been eating as much.
Ah.
It's not been intentional or anything like that.
Jay, let me ask you, you sounded much more upbeat. Are you a little nervous about this TV appearance tonight?
A little bit.
A little bit.
Listen, don't be. Go on. Wear your suit. I imagine they'll treat you nice. I think, isn't Jimmy Kimmel the show where they let you drink if you want before the show and even during the show?
Yeah, that's what you Jay, are you don't strike me as a big drinker. Are you a big drinker?
No, not at all.
Do you drink alcohol at all?
I do just a little bit.
A Zima? Mm-hmm.
Shut up. You might want to have a couple of Zimas.
I'm a single malt Scotch person.
Oh, no. So, well, you know what? Maybe having a nice Scotch.
What's that, like a Bushmill? Is that what I'm thinking?
No, that's Irish whiskey. Single malt Scotch
James?
Would be, yeah, like, no, that's Irish whiskey. Be like a Chivas or a Dewars or something like that, a Scotch.
Oh, well, load up on that, Jay. And whatever you do, have a great time tonight. And you know, we don't want you to say hi to us or anything. We just want you to know that you wouldn't have been there if you weren't on our show.
Yeah, because Jimmy Kimmel steals all the ideas from us.
Anyway, congratulations, Jay. We're going to watch it. And if you don't mind, maybe we'll call you tomorrow. We'll kind of critique your performance.
I might be a little hard to catch tomorrow with airplane schedules and such, but welcome to try.
All right. Well, you got it, Jay. Listen, have a good time tonight with James Kimmel. James Kimmel.
Do you know who else is going to be on the show, Jay?
Yeah, Ozzy and Sharon Osbourne.
Wow.
That's pretty good.
And, hey, listen, Jay, this really, I'm not kidding. You might want to think about putting a Do Not Disturb on your phone.
Yeah, because you gave your phone, you gave your
hotel number you gave the hotel on the air.
Oh, no big deal. I can hang up on people as quickly as anybody.
Okay.
Oh my.
Now they're definitely going to call.
Now it's a challenge. All right, well, Jay will be watching for you tonight, as discovered, as heard, on the Don and Mike Show. Jay Maynard, the Tron guy.
Yeah, and for all of you across the country that want to see Jay and you haven't been on the Internet, you'll get to see him tonight, complete with the whole Tron suit.
Absolutely.
Way to go, Jay!
All right, we'll talk to you later, Jay.
Thanks, guys.
All right, see ya.
Bye.
He's getting so stuck up.
He is. He's not the guy we used to know.
No, he isn't. He really isn't.
You might not be able to get me tomorrow. I might be on a plane.
All right. I think he's got a pucker factor to beat the band.
Mm-hmm.
I think he's terrified.
I can't wait to see what length his hair is, because if you trace him throughout the Tron concert.
He had the long nerd hair.
Right. And then
followed by the short haired hair.
Yeah. But I know one thing we can guarantee is that no matter what, the helmet will still be too small.
And will he or won't he wear a cup?
Yeah.
Will you really see Jay Maynard?
And what if they leave Ozzy and Sharon out there?
I think Ozzy will be scared.
You have to leave Ozzy and Sharon out there.
Yeah. Suit.
Scary. Scary, my son.
Do you think there's a chance that Jay won't panel and they'll just, like, debut him and then pull the curtain? Maybe just, like, as a five-second throwaway?
Oh, like, he doesn't even get interviewed?
Yeah.
You gotta interview
you
the guy. The guy made his own Tron suit.
I'm not going on the same stage with that person.
You know, I watched a couple seconds of the Osbournes this weekend.
Yeah.
I haven't watched in such a long time.
I haven't watched in a while.
I guess it was after Ozzy's ATV accident.
Yeah. Right.
Because he's got the giant collar on.
Now I'm interested.
He's got the collar on.
I took a nose to spill.
And he said, one of the production guys who's there from MTV or from Sharon Show or something, he says,
right.
I just got, you know, I don't do it like he's got the director's cut of Schindler's List. And what he's saying is, he just got the director's cut of Schindler's List
right.
that has 20 seconds that was too gruesome even to be in the film. So he asked all these grips and all of the guys filming his TV show if they want to watch it with him. And Sharon comes home from doing her TV show, and she goes, what's going on? And Ozzy's laying on the couch wearing this gigantic collar because he was in this accident. And he's really reflecting and looking at this. And one of the guys walks in and goes, what are you guys watching? And Ozzy's like, Schindler's List. It's the stuff that they didn't show on the movies.
Wow.
And there's all the sycophants that are sitting there that are afraid to say, you know, hey, Ozzy, we don't feel like watching Schindler's List
in the middle of the afternoon. Wow.
But it was made me think I should go back to watch the Osbournes.
It's pretty gruesome. It's pretty gruesome. Who's the nerd?
So he's going to be on.
Jay Maynard?
He's going to be on tonight with Jay Maynard.
That's a great freak show.
That's good.
Wow.
Oh, goddamn. Your phone calls. Oh. Well, let's take a couple. Then we might just have to extend the phone scan.
Okay. Right on, Don.
Hello, are you there? Don and Mike show. Hello. Oh, we got a couple of seconds for calls. Hello, Don and Mike. You're on the air.
Hey, Don and Mike, Radio Chiefs.
Howdy. Hi, don't call us Chief. Don't call us Chief.
Yeah, okay, Chief.
All right, Chief.
What celebrity does Freda most resemble, I've been wondering?
Hey, Slick, I get asked that a lot.
Yeah?
Yeah, I get asked that an awful lot.
What's your job, pal?
Does she look like me?
No, she doesn't look like you. My wife, the celebrity she most resembles, do you watch Everybody Loves Raymond?
Now and again.
Watch it and check out Raymond's brother's wife.
I don't know.
Raymond's brother's wife.
Yeah. Are you being serious? Because I don't know Raymond's brother's wife. Isn't she like Amazonia?
No, Mike, she's beautiful. She's beautiful.
I thought you were going to say Doris Roberts.
No, now that would be insulting.
I know.
That would be insulting.
Raymond's joke.
Raymond's brother is married to a young, vivacious, beautiful woman.
That's who Freda looks like.
And that's who the celebrity my wife most resembles.
Very exciting.
See, you're going to watch that sometime now, and you're going to laugh when you see her. I don't know how to describe this. This actor, she looks
like a redhead.
Nothing like my wife. I don't know. She's like mousy.
Blonde.
Yeah.
Really?
Always looks like she needs to blow her nose.
Oh.
She's one of those girls always looks stuffed up.
Yeah, I know. Like, I'm trying to think of Mary Louise Parker.
Look at what a surprise. There's the hotline. Hello?
I do not, Sugar Bear.
You do not what?
I don't look like that woman.
Right, okay. Hello? Trying to do a comedy show here.
I know, but not everybody knows you're doing comedy. Sometimes your wit is so sharp and subtle.
That would be like, I guess, a couple of hours ago when you called in to tell me that doctor had sent you an email asking you out even though he knew that you were married.
What? No, that was a reality show.
Oh, that was reality. So,
right.
Oh, okay. Well, let's draw that distinction for our listeners then. That my wonderful, beautiful wife, really doesn't look like the girl, the wife of Raymond's brother.
Thank you,
okay. Frida. Who would you say is the celebrity you most resemble? I don't think we've ever asked.
I want to tell you this though. Really, when I think of you, you look like her, but only when I'm drinking and alone. when I try to picture you when I'm drinking alone, which is sad.
Right.
My wife told me it's sad that I drink alone.
I find it ironic that you are insecure when I tell you that somebody else that I don't care at all about, but some stranger asked me out, and the way you respond to your insecurity is by getting belligerent with me, as if that will make me cling tighter to you.
I'm not insecure about that. I'm pissed, and I'm pissed because the guy sent you an email saying, hey, you've already established the fact that the guy knows you're married, and he still asked you out, and what you don't do is send him a note back saying, hey, pal, I told you I'm married. Your way to handle it is just not to respond to it.
A non-response is a negative answer.
Well, All right, all I know is that you look just like the girl on Everybody Loves Raymond.
But all I know is that when you are worried about me leaving you, you treat me worse. And it seems to be counterproductive to me.
When I'm worried about you leaving me. Since when am I worried about you leaving
me? When you get jealous of me because you don't, because, I mean, it's an insecurity just the way I get jealous of you because everybody has a little insecurity. But the difference is when I'm worried about you, I kiss up to you in hopes that you will not go anywhere and you treat me worse. You're belligerent with me when you're worried.
All I said is that you look like the girl. I was making a joke that you look like the girl on the radio show.
I'm saying when you called me witchy names, and now you said you're mad at me.
I'm making your decision to leave me easier.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
That's all I'm doing.
You make it very hard, sometimes, Sugar Bear. Thank you. I love you nonetheless.
Who is the celebrity you most resemble, in your opinion?
I get told whomever my hair looks like, I look like. Hmm. And so now my hair is blondish, and I get told, I don't even like this, but this isn't flattering to say it either, but I get told Meredith Baxter Bundy.
From Family Guy.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, that's it.
She's attractive. She looks like Robert's brother, or Raymond's brother, Robert's wife.
Now I'm the brother.
No, honey, listen, let it go.
All right.
Let it go. It was a joke. You don't look anything like her.
All right. I'll turn on the radio and just laugh, okay?
Well, good. That's why I'm here, to make people laugh.
All right. Thank you.
Bye.
All right. Goodbye, CP.
Okay, love you.
Love you, too.
See ya. Bye-bye. You mark my words, it started about a week and a half ago. Really? Really?
What's the end game here?
I don't know. I mean, I'm playing along with you. I don't know.
This jockey found with hatchet in forehead.
I don't know. You know, I've said
this jockey was found with a hatchet in his forehead the other night.
I've said a million things about her over the radio for whatever reason now. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Maybe her doctor was listening today.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry about that, Doc.
You never know.
If Dr. Demento or Dr.
That's what we have to do is find the doctor.
Dr. Giggles.
Dr. Giggles, yes, sir.
Find out whoever it is.
Dr. Detroit.
Your phone calls. God, please let's take calls. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Don and Mike.
Hey, howdy.
How are you?
We're doing.
I know. I'm supposed to let you guys run the ship, but I had a great idea for a Dude Walker bumper.
Did you say ship?
He did.
Thank you.
Like sailing ship.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
All right. Bye.
What was that?
I just hung up on him. I don't know.
Disjointed.
Hello, Todd and Mike. Hello.
My friends, how you doing?
Hi, we're doing great. Thank you.
I want to know if we could sort of get an insight into your behind the scenes in your show. I want to know, when you guys get to work, and are you involved in writing any of the bits? And, Mike, have you ever done stand-up?
Let me answer all of those questions. We arrive at the building about 7:30 in the morning. Man. Everything is...
Come on. Give me the props.
Mike gets here earlier.
A little earlier.
Mike's first one here, and everything is written. Everything is scripted. We have a room of writers, and, yes, Mike does do stand-up.
I have a six-year contract with the Improv. And I perform at Improvs around the
Mike
country.
Mike uses the name Gary Valentine.
Gary Valentine is my stage name.
And you know, it begins long before you guys get here. You rise at 1 in the morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We do, just like Bob Edwards from NPR.
Well, we do that, the 4 or 5 hours of work at home prior.
The prep. So there you go. Have we answered your question? Now, this is not in the script, so we really have to get back to the show.
Great. Thank you very much, fellas.
Thank you.
I'm glad we could help.
Have a good
Thank
one.
You.
Good luck.
You
Be happy. Make somebody else.
I'm there.
We'll do that.
We had this time.
And Mike, he'll see you on the board.
He can't see it on the radio, but I just tugged my earlobe at him.
Okay.
Ah, way to go.
We'll do an entire phone scan. I really
we'll
don't
get
know.
Some better callers.
I don't know what happened.
No, we won't.
I don't know.
No, you're right. Now, don't be a negative person.
Sorry. Stop it, guys. Your calls on the phone scan. Oh, and the last person will win a trip to Los Angeles.
Hallelujah.
For goodness sake. So keep calling. We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
And you can get news, weather, and the latest news and weather on Fox 5 News at noon. And we'll see you again tomorrow. Do drive safely.
All right, we're in the victory circle. I can't get it. Ah, here it comes. Take it. Yeah!
What is this lady doing on TV?
Yeah!
The Don and Mike Show.
totally refreshing.
Noted Bonesman, Don Geronimo, and Michael Mara.
You know, we're going to get your phone calls in here, and it's a Buzz's News Show time. I got a new game. I got a whole bunch of new games I'm not going to get to today. I promise we'll play one of them tomorrow. Plus, tomorrow we'll have an update from Jay Maynard after he goes on the Jimmy Kimmel show tonight.
Jay Maynard, who's just so full of himself right now.
Tron guy. He's hot, baby.
He is as hot as yesterday.
Plus, tomorrow, something to do with a Queer Eye for the Straight Guy.
Huh.
I don't know if it's they've got a book on tape that like tells straight guys how to be gay or something. Whatever. We'll get to that.
And by Vito.
Oh, and a good one from our wacky story file for tomorrow's show that we didn't get to today.
Good.
Another friend from the past. Not Dr. James Caper past.
Right.
A friend from the recent past.
Very, very good.
Phone calls here, 877-365-3636. Somebody wins a trip to Los Angeles here. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hello, Don and Mike. How are you?
Hey, we're doing great, thank you.
I didn't realize I was first on. That means I don't get to win the flight, huh?
What was that? I'm sorry. You got to slow it down a little bit. You know we're Americans.
Speak American, there, pal.
Oh, I'm saying I'm first on the phone scam, but I don't get to win the flight to Los Angeles.
That's right. And oh, I forgot to mention it wouldn't really matter because all winners have to be American citizens.
Well, I'm nearly American. I'm married to one.
You married one?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So that makes you a citizen.
But you've not converted yet, have you?
No, I haven't converted yet. No.
Have you renounced the Queen and pledged your allegiance to the United States?
I'm almost there.
Almost there. Call me back when you're ready to bleed red, right, and blue.
And how do you like me giving them the Patriot drill there?
There
huh?
you go.
Have I learned after all these
That's
years?
That's my guy.
Yeah.
Johnny Appleseed.
Yeah, and you're Johnny Patriot.
Mike O'Mara's America. Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Don and Mike.
Howdy.
Yes, I drink alone, and I have cigars at home. Freedom must be hot. She's not a bot.
What are you writing, but a Dr. Seuss book?
But Don may have to be a clone.
I tell you, you know, lately on these phone scans, there's so much giving. There's giving.
After that call, I noticed something stunk, and I thought, maybe Mike farted. But then I listened to what you said, and I realized you're retarded. Your call stinks.
Well done.
Not the fart. Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello, you're on the air.
Hey, boy.
Oh, hi there. Hi, ma'am. Hi, lady.
How are you?
Hi, lady.
How are you doing?
Honey?
Hey, Mike.
Hi there. What's going on? You know, I love this tone. How are you?
I'm fine.
Isn't that kind of funny? You know, the way when the voice goes up at the end. What's going on?
Hey.
I wanted to let Mike know.
Mike?
I'm a returning patron to the coolest cafe in Northern Virginia.
Thanks. Look around, cafe.
Very, very
yes.
good. Thank
hey
you.
Hey, now.
Mike, you have got to book that band again from Saturday night.
Okay. I will. I promise.
You know,
I was here. I was thinking this was going to go in a totally different direction.
Yeah,
I thought it was going to be a little bit more of a sexy call.
She was another satisfied customer.
Of course, that's the new theme song for the restaurant. Yeah, the new theme, the slug line. You know,
which is
come to O'Mara's where you always feel sexy.
Thanks. Look around, cafe.
And you know, I must tell you something about that sign.
Yeah,
the look around
cafe
sign. Yes, people are starting to talk. People are starting to. I'm going to have to go make one.
You're going to have to get one. There you go.
Yeah.
You have to get one. Sure.
Hey,
did you?
You said you had one coming.
The Look Around Cafe?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, hold on a second.
Hey, gentlemen.
I don't know whether you were, whether you did or you didn't.
You know what? Hold on a
but
second.
But if you didn't, I'm going to go ahead and do
I ordered
it.
You the Red Sox sign.
People, the number one thing people say is, where's the sign?
Mm-hmm. Give me a second. Give me a second. For goodness sakes. You know, I bet I did. I bet I did.
Well, if you didn't, let me know, because I'm going to go ahead and have it put up.
Let me call you tonight.
Okay,
at home.
Fine. It doesn't matter.
I did.
Just this weekend, was saying that to me. Where are you going to put it?
I did, because I got it from the same place as I got that Red Sox sign.
As a matter of fact, Don, forget it. We're going to do the full-fledged name change.
Mike, look around.
More people know it is that than anything else.
Hey, now.
Hey, now.
Find Mike's toenail. Your meal is free.
Yum, yum, and a marble.
Hello. Don and Mike show. Hello.
Don, this is your wife's doctor.
Hey,
oh, dear.
The email was for you, Don, not her.
Oh, really?
Oh, well, that's different.
Okay.
The whole show's got a veto quality to it.
Hello.
Mike. Okay. Hell, hello.
Hey, Don and Mike, my mom's a whore.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for the bulletin.
Congratulations.
Like we all don't know it already.
Really?
Our best to your mom. Hello, Don and Mike.
Yeah, I was wondering if you guys knew that they re-signed the voices to The Simpsons.
Oh, they did?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
We didn't know that.
So yeah, excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, we have a newsman over here that you've just made very upset.
That was one of Buzz's stories today.
Oh, I apologize, Buzz.
You owe me $1.06 now.
I'm sorry about that, Buzz.
No, you're not.
No. Yeah, I am, actually. No.
Are you really?
Yeah, I am.
Okay.
I hate to mess up a phone call once you get in, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, you know, take it up with Buzz, dude, because, you know, Buzz has the news part. Go ahead, Buzz, kick his ass. Go ahead, Buzz.
What's with you, dude? What possessed you? Why did you feel you had to call with that?
No, because I knew Mike was... You know, doing the voices and stuff like that.
Right.
There was a glimmer of chance.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And when we... when we did that story on the news, that would have been when Mike jumped in and did that, but now you've just wrecked the whole thing.
He was calling about me, so stop hog-dogging him.
No, but, you know, that's it.
See, now you've spoiled it for everyone.
All right, goodbye.
No, we got that early, that's all.
What do you mean you got that early?
No, we got that bit you guys would have done later, early.
I think it's time for you to pull the ripcord.
Eject! Maverick, eject!
Time to hang up, sir. There you go.
Good boy.
Thank you. You know, we're going to have to get Top Gun music in here.
Uh-huh.
I think every once in a while, if we get one of those callers, mm-hmm. we're going to have to play Danger Zone.
Hey, you know, the Air and Space Museum has flight simulators.
See that, Mike?
That's
number one, pal.
That's the same response you gave me before when I mentioned the Air and Space.
I'm not taking my wife to a museum.
Mm-hmm.
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Don and Mike, Radio God.
It's not a museum. It's an airline hangar.
Hello. Yeah, you're on the air. Hi. I'll watch it if it's on TV.
They have TVs in there.
No, I mean, I'll watch it if it's on TV in my house.
Oh, maybe they'll have it on the Discovery Channel.
I don't like the Discovery Channel. It has to be on one of the channels I like. It has to be on ESPN or on HBO.
Okay.
Or on Fox.
Not
I pretty much like anything
what about
on
Discovery. You've never watched Discovery HD?
Huh?
Sure.
Huh?
Okay.
But only Trading Places.
Okay.
That's true. I don't like watching like Animals Mate.
Really?
But on high definition.
I sure do.
On high definition, I do watch Trading Places.
You might be able to see it on Fox, but it would be like America's Most Outrageous Airplane.
You know, it's funny when you walk in. This is a funny story. When I'm going into this museum the other day, and it's crowded because it's Sunday and it's kind of a nasty day. And this guy, in one of the first you walk down the hallway and suspended like they so many...
The cure for pronated foot.
I'm sorry.
The Don and Mike Show.
Like so many of the planes, they're suspended from the ceiling. And one of them's upside down.
Mm-hmm.
And a guy right next to me says to his wife, "Hey, that one's upside down." And I just looked at the guy.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't want to say anything, but I was so desperate to say,
you did
thank
Jeff
you for pointing that out to
you
me.
Went to the you went to the Air and Space Museum yesterday?
Yes.
Did you take your kids?
No.
No. Take your girlfriend?
Yes.
Mm. That's because you're dating.
Do they have
no, them? She didn't want to go.
You made her
good
go?
For you.
Yeah.
Do they have a rigid airship?
I mean, it's not they made her go, but she didn't really want to go. She wanted to go to that grocery store that I told you about, so we went to both places. But the trip to the museum, you know me, I like planes. I'm into planes.
Yeah, you like them so much you love flying.
No,
I've never known anybody who likes flying as much as you.
Don't you know the ABCs of me a little bit?
You're fascinated by everything flying. I know you are.
Fascinated by everything flying, and I'm also scared. It's the,
your queer duality.
It's the queer duality.
It's just, you're killing me.
I'm nervous now, Buzz, because they're both looking at me.
Be nervous.
You're killing me because I just spent the majority of today's show talking about how I enjoyed being by myself, drinking by myself, watching TV by myself.
Right.
And here I have you. You went to a museum, and you didn't. It wasn't even because you like trying to impress your girlfriend. You just went because you really like to go, ow!
That hurt!
I'm sorry.
What did you throw at me?
And Larry David Stressball.
That hurt me.
I'm sorry.
LDSB.
Ow. Larry David Stressball.
No, but I mean, what it is, really, I don't like museums either. I really don't.
But you went.
This is a plane. This is a bunch
different.
Of planes.
Do they have
it's like looking at planes. You know I love looking at planes. I love looking at planes.
Any Zeppelins?
No. The Enola Gay.
Forget it.
Get the lead out.
The Enola Gay was there, the one that dropped the atomic.
Hi, I'm Enola.
I'm gay. Hello there.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Hi there. You're on the air.
Just want to let you guys know I love you, and you make my hour and a half commute home fly by.
Oh, does that suck.
And incidentally,
that's
a mile and a half commute, too.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the call. Yeah, no matter what city you're calling us from.
That's right.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Don and Mike.
Hi.
Hi. You guys were talking earlier about what time you get to work. I just wanted to warn you not to get to work too early than you're supposed to, because you might find Alan Limewand on a security guard like in The Sopranos last night.
That's a good call.
Okay, you get a chime. Wouldn't that be something? You come pulling into Alan's head, it goes up like right. like Vito or whatever sure. his name is.
Yeah, there are a few other people I could put in Alan's position.
Hello, not in Mike's show. Some of them don't work here anymore.
Michael. Oh.
Hello.
Hey. Hello.
What can we do for you? Hello? I think he thought he said something funny.
Yeah, and then he turned the radio up very loud.
He thought he said something hilarious.
Why was he wrong?
Hello,
I hear that.
Don and Mike.
Hey, what's up?
Hey.
This is Franklin.
Hi, Franklin.
In Lodi, California. I'm the only black man living in this town, by the way.
In Lodi? You're the only black guy in Lodi?
We'll fix that.
All Germans, man. Robbie would be happy to hear that.
How could that be? How could you be a black man living in an all-German town?
It's just happened that way. You live where you can live. On The Sopranos last night, why were they blaming the black man about everything?
Yeah, that's their thing. Yeah. That's what those guys do.
That was the title
of
the show.
They blame the brothers for everything that happened.
Three different times. A black man did this, a black man did that. Mm-hmm. It was all made up.
Right. And you know The Sopranos, they're big Germans.
What's that?
The episode was titled... Unidentified Black Males.
Oh, okay.
And you know the reason. The Soprano family, their roots deeply into German history.
God.
Right. Tony's all German.
Goodbye. I mean, auf Wiedersehen.
Stugatz, hey, Seacrest out.
All right.
Bye-bye. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, Don and Mike.
Oh. Hey, Rob, I think you just found a town you can vacation in,
there
though.
You go. Lodi.
Lodi, California.
Lodi.
One black man. And everybody else is German.
Mm-hmm. Only one thing wrong with it.
Hello. Don and Mike.
Rob. Don and Mike.
Yeah, hi. God.
Yo, when are you going to play the Chiefs game again?
Well, I don't know, Chief.
We just played last week, Slick.
Yeah, it was even funnier than when Letterman used to do it on his show.
Okay, sport.
Yeah, that's
exact
right.
Same game.
That's right, mm-hmm. Slick, because everything is stolen by somebody else. Is that what you're intimating here, Chief?
It's the same game, Chief. Man. Why are you ripping off crap you saw on TV like that?
If you stick around, we're coming. We've got Stupid Petricks coming up in the next segment. We did it to tick you off.
Hey, and Chief, for the record, I swear to God, I mean, I don't doubt it was done on Letterman.
Letterman did that.
I didn't see it.
I watched Letterman all the time.
When was it on Letterman?
A couple years ago. He used to do it a lot. But
Chief,
Wait, hold on.
The Chief game?
I don't recall that.
The exact same Chief game. Mm. Exactly.
Well, you're right. I saw it, and I've been saving it for 2 years, waiting to steal it until I thought, God, but what if a guy who's so smart mm-hmm. calls the show and knows that?
It.
Oh! I'm
not blaming you.
I'm so busted.
Hey, stay tuned for travel trivia. We got travel trivia coming up.
Gotta hire new writers, better writers.
And yes, George Bush George Bush is trying to look interested.
Yes, we have to get better writers. How long have I said that? Our writers stink.
Hey,
you know what? I'll tell you. Why don't we fix this right now? How would you like to come and write for the show?
I've got a lot of free time.
You got some free time? All right. Why don't you give us we'll give you the last word to pitch us on some idea or some thought.
Is this Letterman thing was a coincidence, something mm-hmm. he had done? I don't doubt it, but give us something better.
Right off the top of your head, we'll give you the last chance to come up with an idea. Fire away.
Okay. You find some...
Okay. Hello, Don and Mike show. How about this for an idea? We hang up on some dumb guy.
That's hilarious.
I love it. Hello, Don and Mike.
Don and Mike, my brother.
Chief. Who cares if Letterman did it? I bet we did it funnier, Chief.
Amen, Chief.
Right, Slick. Hello.
Don and Mike.
Yes, Dud.
How you doing?
How you doing, sport?
Doing fine, brother.
Hey, I've got a little bit of advice from The Sopranos last night.
Yeah, what's that, my man?
Call every lawyer in the state so that just in case anything happens, Freda can't go to him.
Okay, thank you. That was
my
plan.
Don't think my ears didn't perk up a little bit when that scene was up.
That's my plan after talking to my wife today. We've been calling every lawyer in the state so she can't talk to them.
Yeah, I'm with you, brother.
Called every liquor store in the state. I will tell you.
Okay, Chief.
All right, Chief.
Hey, didn't I see Letterman do that, though, one time on
uh-huh.
his show?
2 years ago. You know, it won't be a very tough thing considering we live in Washington, D.C.
Hello, yeah. John and Mike show. Hello. Are you there? No, how about that one? Line 3. Hi, Don and Mike show.
Don, Mike, Vox is loose, Rob.
Vox is loose, Rob.
Just got back from St. Louis, Minnesota. Want to tell you that the weather's there pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love your show, guys.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Thank you.
Hey, Buzz.
Yeah.
Eject,
goddamn it! Hello, Don and Mike show.
You first.
Hey, Donnie. What kind of Xbox Live games have you been playing lately, and what's your
hold on. Yeah. We're running out of time. What was the question?
What kind of Xbox Live games are you playing lately?
You can't do it with a straight face.
Oh, God, Xbox Live. He's trying to do it and cracked himself up.
I'd be glad to tell you it's NFL Fever.
Is that the only one?
That's the only one that I play online.
What's your code?
What's your code?
What's your code?
Listen, this pains me. You're funny, but I hate to give you a prize.
Tommy, I love you.
You're busting my balls. You listen to the last caller on the phone scan, so we have to know what be thy name?
Adam.
Adam, where are you from, Adam?
Baltimore.
All right, Adam, on Live 105, here you go. You got a trip for two to Los Angeles, my friend.
Oh, my God, I love you, Don.
To go to the 2004 Taurus World Stunt Awards. Trip includes 2 nights, 3 days hotel, and event passes to the Stunt Awards at Paramount Studios Hollywood. The TV show with Dennis Hopper, televised Wednesday, May 26, 9 p.m., 8 central on Spike TV, the first network for men. You win because you're the last person on the phone scan.
Woo!
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Don.
Hold on.
It was funny right till the end.
Well done.
It was funny right till the end.
That was a good call.
I like that.
He was trying. What about Xbox?
Yeah.
He was cracking himself up.
Too funny.
And he would have made me laugh even more if I could have understood what he said. What's your code? It's very simple, much like my PIN number at the bank.
Oh. Hey, Don?
Yeah.
Do you want your stress ball back?
You want to throw it at me?
No, I'll toss it to you. There we go.
Yeah,
friendly.
I'll say, I'm a nice guy.
Oh, my. I almost just threw it back at Mike, but yeah. I'm such a bad throw. I couldn't even. You're 3 feet away from me.
That was a Murphy throw.
Hey! Oh. God, why you?
We're owning a radio
that
was strictly forbidden. One man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Who is Buzz?
Me.
He made it up.
I'm keeping it now.
I know you are. You got it in your hand.
I'm keeping it.
Don't hit me with it.
Don't hurt me.
Hey, Buzz?
Yeah.
Buzz, what's your lead?
Today.
On the news and the comments show?
Today, police give Michael Jackson's underoos a good going over.
Ew. Now, this is a story that we need to dive into.
Yeah. Do we really?
Yes, we do.
Stay tuned for everybody.
News and comments coming up
on the Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike Show. That was very
professional.
Don't hurt me.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
The Don and Mike Show.
What's the word from Planet Crackpot?
Gotcha.
Noted Chubby Chasers, Don Geronimo and Mike O'Mara.
Right. Time for Buzz's News and Comment now. Buzz brought to you by Duramax, world's number one sexual pleasure performance enhancer, Duramax.
Someone called for a doctor.
Number one, because it works. Doctor developed, clinically tested, and patented. Veramax, available at retailers nationwide. The 1-888-TRI-VMAX. I'll play this one for Jeff Gordon, 24 call. They were throwing beers at him. Don't matter. It weren't popular, that victory. Big winner he was out in Hollywood yesterday.
Yeah, but they didn't like it none.
Not actually Hollywood, whoever. Like, they say Hollywood, but it's like an hour away where the NASCAR race was yesterday.
Yeah, and they was mad that he won another race.
Too bad.
Because folks don't like him. Don't like him like they do Junior.
I'll tell you the problem, Mike. It's a problem that both you and I have. The same problem that Jeff Gordon has.
We've suffered from it our entire career.
Listen, yes. When you're scary talented and, then, Buzz, I'll use the word that people use behind our backs.
Okay.
Handsome. When you're handsome and talented, other people just, they don't want you to do well. They look for you to fail.
Right. Yeah, and we can't help it that we're good looking.
No.
We really can't.
Talented. Us and Jeff Gordon.
You are what you want.
We're dreaming.
Mm-hmm. It is what it is. Every morning we get up and both look in the mirror and we just go, wow.
Perfect.
You're across the bear.
I can't tell you how many times we leave the station, people throw beer at us.
Yeah, because they're jealous.
That's right.
Ridiculous.
I was.
Hi, Don and Mike, you handsome devil.
Boogity, boogity, boogity. Let's get ready to race, boys.
Have you ever heard of...
No. That's what DW says at the beginning of the race.
Is that what he says?
Darrell Waltrip, when they're coming around for the green flag,
mm-hmm. right?
He says, boogity, boogity, boogity. You got all the moron NASCAR fans that are holding up big signs in the stands that go boogity, boogity, boogity.
And that's the smartest thing you can say, boogity, boogity. I mean, that's...
Yeehaw!
That's pretty simple.
I'm telling you, it works for me, though.
It does?
It says to me, it's race time.
Hey, look, you brought it right into our show. There you go, stealing from other people again.
Mm-hmm.
Letterman, mm-hmm. Letterman, Leno.
Leno, Montel,
Mike Douglas. Hi, bud.
Hi, Don and Mike. A couple of months ago, we told you about a New Jersey man who'd acquired some Michael Jackson memorabilia. He got it from a storage place in New Jersey where Michael hadn't paid the storage bill. Jackson fought in court to get the stuff back, but the man won it and planned to sell it to a collector in England. I remember saying at the time, it sounds more like evidence, these items. Now, that's the way investigators see it in Michael's child molestation case. They've seized the stuff, which includes two pairs of Jacko's underwear, believed to contain bodily fluids that would render a DNA sample. That sample would be compared to other samples collected at the Neverland Ranch from his mattress and elsewhere.
You know, God forbid, you know, at least if they, you know, I'm trying to think if my world was turned upside down like this, and they came in like with the CSI black lights, you know what they find? Like, they just find me.
Mm-hmm.
That's right. All they find.
Everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Everywhere, Buzz. But,
yeah.
But at least it would only be me. I mean, it would be
you.
It would be embarrassing, but it would just be me.
That's right.
Or it would be my wife in my underpants. That's it. You wouldn't find, right. You know, with little kids from Star Search or kids with cancer in my underpants.
Well, we're going to find out, I think, soon enough what the real deal is.
I think so.
And am I the only one that thinks this way now? When I listen to radio, whether it's satellite radio or terrestrial radio, whatever I'm listening to, and I hear the disc jockey just come on and go, "Hey, good afternoon. Michael Jackson, the way you make me feel on Mix 107. Don't you feel like screaming at the radio? Hey, how come the disc jockey is not at least saying, "Here's Michael Jackson, who's a great entertainer, but we all know he's a kid toucher. Mix 107.3.
It's kind of unusual in the way that it's being handled. I mean, I don't know whether the gravity, if these allegations are proven true and they get the evidence and they come out with specific, you know, things that happen. I mean, this it can't even be stressed enough how horrible,
how serious and nasty
these things are if they went on there. And you know what, man? It's really, I just think all it's about is, you know, whether he's going to have 1,000 of his fans there, whether he's going to dance on top of the car, you know.
And how it'll affect record
sales. If there are kids involved in this, I don't know. I mean, I think because of the culture of celebrity in this country, we lose sight of what's really important.
From that warehoused memorabilia, police also seized the cautionary note about pedophiles Michael wrote to the mother of his nephews. You may remember us discussing that a month or so ago.
Yeah.
They also found the note he'd written to the kids visiting Neverland. It began, "Dear Rubbers," and referred to the kids as rubberheads. They found a list of rules for that rubberhead club.
Dear Rubbers.
Wow. The list of rules for the rubberhead club include, know the Peter Pan story by heart.
Dear Dildos.
And when seeing another club member, quote, give the peace sign and then half of it. They found a Norman Rockwell painting of nearly naked boys running from a swimming hole. They found a Longfellow.
God.
A Henry Wadsworth Longfellow poem called The Children's Hour. They found a sketch of a boy. And they found a personalized California license plate that reads, "All Boys." That's what they found in the warehouse.
Now, is that Michael Jackson's license plate or just something that was, like, sent to him?
That would have to be researched by the police. All I know is there was a personalized California license plate in that warehouse stuff from New Jersey that just said, "All Boys."
So having said all of that and knowing that your audience knows all of this,
right?
Here's what I don't get. When I'm turning on the radio, why do I hear this? Good afternoon, Pat Smear here. Here, the King of Pop with the Jackson 5.
I understand that.
Don't you think that really, I mean,
guilty until proven innocent, though. That's,
But why couldn't you at least do this?
I mean the other way around.
Michael Jackson up on some tremendous charges. We'll keep you through here at Mix 108.
I agree.
You know what I mean?
I agree. It's that easy.
Instead, what you're doing, because you know your audience is all, especially now, they're wondering, they're going through Michael Jackson's underpants.
Right.
He has Norman Rockwell paintings of naked boys. How can you play the record? You know, it's a better intro. That creep had naked pictures of boys by Norman Rockwell. Shoot him! I mean, I'd rather hear that on the radio
instead of pretending that nothing's happened.
Hey, the king of pop.
Right.
Here he is from that.
No, I'm saying I'm going to make a judgment call here. I think somewhere between where you were and where the disc jockey was that you heard, that'd probably be where it's at.
Well, you think I was too radical?
No, I don't think you're radical at all. That was a joke that I was making. Oh, but I mean, really, the thing is. It just
so was I was
people,
making
people
joke.
blowing it off.
Yeah.
It's just it's weird.
I think people are uncomfortable.
It's almost like, you know, when you watch a movie, they say if you watch too much violence on TV, mm-hmm. you get desensitized
yep.
to it.
Yeah,
I mean, that's a nobody's factor. Talking about what this is.
Plus, nobody knows how to handle it. I think most people don't know how to feel or what to say.
I think he knows how to handle it.
Do you know what
he
really
knows what he knows about?
I think all the court TV and all the court cases and the way now this is just one big entertainment for people.
Mm-hmm.
I think that we've forgotten what you know. Why we have a judicial system. I mean, it's more like a game than anything else. And that takes away what the whole Lacey Peterson thing.
Well, everybody
it's
has...
the same thing.
Everybody has their own logo. If you watch court TV, and I watched it last week for Jason Williams, you have up on the screen, whoosh, you know, the big graphic, the Jason Williams trial, and then whoosh, the Kobe Bryant trial. And then it was, after that, it was whoosh, Scott Peterson, right. And then who?
Yeah, the Scott Peterson thing. I mean, it's just like, hey, what's the prosecution doing? What's the defense doing? Does anybody ever talk about, I mean, we're talking about a woman who was murdered while she was carrying
mm-hmm.
a baby. I mean, God. And then nobody talks about that.
Truth and justice. Where
and,
are those?
And I think on court TV, then they also had like something like sentencing. Martha Stewart, mm-hmm. and they got the graphic of sentencing on the 17th. Robert Blake, in October. Court TV, don't miss a moment.
Right. And Martha Stewart, I mean, she lied about taxes. She lied about investments.
Right.
You know, all right. Well, whatever.
Like, for instance,
I was wondering,
how can a disc jockey play this?
People, because
not at least say to his audience, or her audience,
hey, ladies and gentlemen, are you feeling creepy now?
Yeah, right. Right, you just said it all, that's all. Yeah. That was it. Especially when you hear him talking.
When you hear the whispering.
Hey, everybody, don't you feel creepy?
Here's one to make you uncomfortable.
Hey, no, give me one more.
All right, hold on a second. Give me the same one. Hold on, here we go. Just a second.
Yes, right. 28 minutes after 6 o'clock on WAVA. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, thinking about sending your kids to camp this summer? I don't know.
There you go. I don't think so.
Did we really believe he was talking to a girl? You know, tomorrow I'm going to bring in a copy of, what was I listening to over the weekend? I wanted to bring in it from a Paul McCartney album.
Mm. The girl is mine.
Yes.
Mine.
The girl is mine. Because there's a portion in that song where they stop singing, they start talking. And mm-hmm. Paul says, listen, Michael, she's mine. You've got to stay with her.
She's mine.
She's mine.
You know, we were joking about that way back then, though. I mean, it was still because he was...
I can get her.
Yeah, right.
I can get her.
The world's creepiest song now is PYT.
Pretty Young Thing.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Pretty Young Thing.
Where's my license plate with boys?
Because he starts the song by saying something like, you're my PYT.
Mm-hmm.
PYT. Bum, right. Bum. Pretty Young Thing.
Hi, rubbers.
Wow. Wow. The terrorism blame.
Thank God Mix 107. Thank God Mix 107 still plays my records and doesn't
Thank you
it.
For ignoring my legal troubles.
Thank you, Celeste Clark.
Good morning.
You know, I was
I want to tell you something. This is Pat Smear. Say what you will. Still the king of pop. That's what you hear on most radio stations.
Like nothing's happened.
We're going to totally ignore all the charges against him. Ladies and gentlemen, Michael Jackson! Isn't he marvelous?
Yeah, terrible accusation, but hey, how about this music?
Tell you what. I dare you. Walk up and ask him if you can smell his fingers.
Where else would you rather be?
Oh, hey, man.
No, that worked. That was tight.
Yeah. I meant to hit that one, which is right next to...
Where else would you rather be?
To that one.
Than right here, right now.
We're all agreed. He's creepy.
Mm-hmm.
And this whole thing is creepy.
Yeah, I mean, in whatever happens with the trial, he will not, his creepydom will not diminish at all. In fact, it'll be enhanced.
I think so. The terrorism blame game continues, meanwhile. Former President Clinton told the 9/11 Commission last week he had warned incoming President Bush that Osama bin Laden would be Bush's number one problem. But in the unrecorded, behind-closed-doors, unsworn testimony of the president last week, Bush said that's not true. Bush told the lawmakers that Clinton probably mentioned terrorism, but, quote, did not make it a point of emphasis. Bush says Clinton seemed a lot more passionate about the dangers of North Korea and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
Well, again, Dr. James Capers was on the show. Mm-hmm. I don't remember the longitude and the latitude.
All I know is he's in Saudi Arabia, Don. That's what Dr. Capers said.
26-point-something and 50-point-something.
26.43 north, longitude 50.10 east. Yeah.
That's where latitude. Osama bin Laden is.
Saudi Arabia.
Go get him, boys.
Dr. James Capers.
Hey, everybody. How are you doing?
I've heard some of the comments made by some of the shock jocks. How are you doing? This is Harvey Fisher. I want to say, it's very tough for me to say, Michael Jackson is guilty.
Wow. I'm 26, number one record. And here's one of them right now on the station that doesn't talk about the charges. Mix 108.
Mix 108.
Very nice.
The best mix of murders and pedophiles. That even the boss can agree on.
But it's a good thing Bush isn't running for office in Canada. A new survey shows that more than 80% of Canadians have a strong dislike for the man. Nearly half of Canadians.
You mean for the invasion?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what it is. Rob, incidentally, if you just tuned in and you haven't heard that theory, Rob does believe that the Canadians are going to invade us.
Why do you think 92% of their populace live within 4 miles of the border?
They're all getting ready for the attack,
that's
Rob.
That's right.
I'm telling you, you're looking the wrong way, son.
Mm-hmm.
Go down south. Go down south. Mm-hmm. Do you see billboards in Canadian and American in America? No, you don't.
Mm-hmm.
No. It's going to be Mexico is going to be the country that invades. Some might say they've already invaded.
You guys are going to debate that forever. Which way? Which direction?
I say they're coming from down south.
I say up north.
No, down south, yeah. Rob.
North.
Either way, we're being violated.
And I tell you, it's going to come by sea, and it's New Zealand.
Really?
Yeah, they speak our language. Hell of a Navy.
What? That would be a listen, for me, that would be a step up.
Mm-hmm.
You bring somebody from another country, they speak American?
Right.
Okay, welcome.
Yeah, people start calling you a Kiwi.
I'm no Kiwi.
Nearly half of Canadians in that same survey said they think our two countries ought to have closer and more friendly ties.
Are you saying I'm a fruit?
A Kiwi is the name for a New Zealander.
I know. But isn't it also a fruit?
It is a fruit. Kiwi fruit.
And
delicious fruit.
Right.
Tastes like strawberry.
And speaking of people who've been wrongly charged,
yes.
Let's not forget Kiwi Herman.
Kiwi Herman.
Uh-huh. You'll be sorry, Kiwi.
Ah!
The survey results were released just hours before the Canadian Prime Minister was expected to meet with the American President.
Take off.
A major general in the Massachusetts National Guard is apologizing for the email he sent last week making fun of the upcoming Democratic National Convention. He forwarded an email that claimed to be the official program for the convention, opening flag-burning ceremony, anti-war concert by Streisand, gay marriage ceremony, reenactment of Kerry's fake medal toss, and a Free Saddam pep rally. And at least six times on the agenda, Ted Kennedy proposes a toast. The major general will not be punished. He says he first got the email from another state official.
Oh, that's
crazy. That's
all in good fun.
That's
sure.
The internet. That's like where you get something where Bart Simpson's having sex with Mickey Mouse.
That's right.
That's funny. That's always good
sure
fun.
Sure it is.
Sure, use that on your Christmas cards.
Some 75 strip club owners in Wisconsin are taking this election very seriously.
Let's take a moment to salute
the strip club owners.
Because I'm positive they're the reason that our show's on in Wisconsin. And I don't care what city you're talking about.
Sure.
Milwaukee or Madison or Wausau.
They all got them?
I guarantee that. That's right. The only clients we got on the air.
Well, those bar owners are asking their patrons to register and vote for Kerry. From the strip clubs are even providing registration forms and envelopes and stamps even. The club owners are hanging signs and printing leaflets. Quoting one, under the Bush administration, the industry, that's what we call it, the industry, has already taken a serious step backward. At what point is the country run under the New Testament rather than under the Constitution? Quoting a lawyer, a lot of people realize that if George Bush gets 3 appointments to the Supreme Court, this industry is going to be dead. Quoting one customer, I've never been asked if I wanted to vote.
How weird is that?
Yeah. Don't lick the stamp. What's
no.
the joke?
If you're going to get a stamp at a strip club,
don't lick it.
There's also some joke
they tend
about...
To be but he's,
I bet we can't tell it anymore.
Go ahead, lick it.
We used to. hey, watch it, you.
Sorry about that.
Mr. Blukarski, you're on double secret probation.
I will be quiet for the rest of the show.
Buzz, we got a break.
All right.
When we come back... Oh, don't be quiet for the rest of the show.
I'll just be clean.
Just stop saying lick it.
That's right, exactly.
Buzz, what's next?
Naked pictures of female cadets.
Oh, great. Mike's going to say lick it. Okay, we'll be right back.
Clean this. is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, and...
Come on.
Charmingly ghetto. The Don and Mike Show.
Yeah. Now, once again, here's Buzz with the news.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Hi, Buzz.
A West Point cadet has been accused of taking nude and semi-nude photos of some of the female cadets and posting them on the Internet without their permission.
Oh. What?
The 23-year-old from Kentucky is charged with 15 violations of the Uniform Code of Military Justice. He now faces up to 25 years in a military prison and a dishonorable discharge.
About 25 years?
25 years.
For taking naked pictures?
Yeah.
Wow.
You get those videos, and all you need to make that video better, you have a pig and a dog in a fight to the death.
Yeah, dog hogging.
Hog-dogging. Hog-dogging.
Hog-dogging.
Hog-dogging while you're looking at naked female cadets.
Wow.
Wow.
Man, and you get Michael Jackson's underpants? You know what that is? That's a recipe for a party.
Yeah, but you're all you heard in the story, if you do that, it's going to result in a discharge.
Oh, no. So, where are people getting the money to pay these higher prices for gasoline? Well, they're spending less on groceries. That's what the grocery stores say. An analysis by the Food Marketing Institute shows that more folks are shopping at cut-rate grocery stores since the price of gasoline went up. The average grocery bill, by the way, is about $90 a week.
And, you know, ain't it a bitch that really everywhere now it's over $2 a gallon. I mean, I know there are some spots in the TV stations around the thing. Oh, listen, this, we found a spot where it's only $1.80 a gallon.
Getting me a hybrid.
Yeah,
there you go.
Really?
You want to pick me up a hybrid?
Yeah. Really?
No.
No, I didn't.
No, I like me the big engines.
I know.
Without that solar.
You know what a hybrid for you would be? Eventually, your dream is always to have Rob in a rickshaw.
Yes.
Rob driving. Rob
That'd
would
be
have
my
to,
perfect hybrid.
Rob with one of those rice paddy hats, just peddling Mike around.
Faster, man, faster.
All right, I'm trying.
Maybe you've heard of the movie about the man who ate just McDonald's for 30 days and nearly died from obesity, higher blood pressure, and higher cholesterol.
I've seen that. Don't tell my wife. That is like an artsy movie that I'd go see.
Yeah, Super Size Me, it's called.
About, it should be about Rob.
Supposed to be a good movie.
Yeah, that's what I hear. It was a winner at the Sundance Film Festival, but it didn't set well with Chaz Weaver of Costa Mesa, California. So he's done a documentary about his 30-day McDonald's diet, on which he says he lost 6 pounds of fat, but lost no muscle mass.
Mm-hmm. See, the original movie that Buzz is talking about, that won the Sundance Award,
the guy got huge,
was a guy who went to McDonald's every day for a month, got incredibly fat, couldn't sleep, had his cholesterol went way up.
Through the roof.
Is like ready for a heart attack in 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy did the same thing.
Had a McDonald's diet, you know, doubt that he ate the same stuff necessarily. And this guy,
there's no way.
Unlike the other guy, this guy says he exercised as he normally would, whereas he said the other guy just stopped exercising, if he ever did, during his 30-day McDonald's diet.
Well, the point being, though, go to McDonald's, with no offense to anybody that goes to McDonald's.
All right.
But go to McDonald's and look at the people there and see how many people you think worked out. Forget today. Forget this weekend.
Ever.
See how many people you think have worked out ever at McDonald's.
Exactly.
The two just don't go together.
Well, this guy with the anti-documentary says it just goes to show that the guy who made Super Size Me did the same thing he'd accused McDonald's of doing, misled the public. No word on when this counter movie comes out, but that may depend on the guy's cholesterol test, which isn't back yet.
And really, I'd like to know what, you know, what he had to eat. Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Did he? Okay, enough with that. Did he have the whatever the?
Did he eat the buns? I'd like to know if he was doing just the protein.
We don't won't know
yet.
And what's the breakfast thing that they have? That just it might
egg McMuffin.
No. The one that is heart attack in plastic.
That's the one where like the sandwich for the egg is a pancake.
And it has syrup and it has bacon
all in it.
It's like something Elvis would invent.
They said the sandwich, whatever, the two griddle cakes are infused with the good flavor of syrup.
Yeah. Oh man. Bacon and syrup, now we're talking.
Here's a man who had one this morning.
I'd like to try to do my latest record. I tried it last night. Then.
Star of Supersize. Here he is.
I don't know the words to it, so I had to read it. If we give it up, just, you know, please forgive us.
McGriddles.
Yeah,
McGriddles. That's what they are. And wait, why don't all these fast food places, I mean, I know they all want to get into the Atkins thing.
Yeah, they're all doing it now.
Yeah.
But, you know, have that, but just be proud of who you are.
I agree.
It's like what I was saying the other day.
Who doesn't like a big greasy cheeseburger?
About 70s music. That, you know, when Barry Manilow was on American Idol, you know, back in the 70s, everybody in this room, we're all, except for Rob, we're all old enough that we were either teenagers or, in Buzz's case, an adult,
yeah,
when his songs were out. Buzz was way past 50 when Barry Manilow was popular. But the point is, someone's got to stand up and say, listen, the songs stink, but, yeah, okay, I'm guilty. Uh-huh. I was there. I knew the words to all the songs. Same with McDonald's. They should, and as a matter of fact, McDonald's, Burger King, Wendy, all of them, they can have their Atkins stuff. But be proud of the fact.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, it's a gigantic, big bowl of stuff that's going to kill you eventually, mm-hmm, but you're going to love the way it tastes.
It's going to be fantastic going down.
It's not healthy for you, but God knows we go through enough crap in life. If you get some satisfaction, mm-hmm, out of eating a hamburger at McDonald's.
And the supersizes, keep the supersizes.
Here's a billboard for you.
When you want to eat it, eat it.
You know, screw the diet, McDonald's.
You know, maybe you just have
to go.
Yeah, why don't you just train your people that work there to say something? Keep the supersize, but everybody that orders one, the guy says something, hey, that'll put you on a slab. Here's your supersize fries, sir. Enjoy.
And here's something that turned out the way we expected it to.
What's that?
The cast of The Simpsons has gone back to work, and everyone got raises, in case you hadn't heard.
Yeah. I heard that.
I'm stubborn. I'm forging ahead with this, despite the caller.
Some guy called the show today. This is old news, Buzz.
I know.
You're just a repeat.
Well, he didn't tell us that the actors had been out for about a month. Now all the key players have signed a deal for 4 more years. He didn't have that part. The show returns for its 16th season this fall. It's the highest-rated scripted show on Fox. And with merchandising, that show is worth, as a property, over $1 billion.
Wow. And again last night, mm-hmm, the first one, the new one.
Right.
There are so many spots of The Simpsons that just make me laugh out loud.
Right.
And
right,
again,
I got to start watching it again.
I'm by myself. I'm drinking. I'm alone, which my wife says is bad, but I don't care. I'm still laughing out loud. Last night, there was one scene. Homer turns into a superhero. I won't bore you with the plot. But Mr. Burns is controlling Homer as he's the superhero.
Mm-hmm.
So Mr. Burns is out. He's disguised. Smithers is wearing a dress and a wig and pushing a baby cart. Inside the baby cart, wearing the bonnet with a little with the thing in his
the rattle
is Mr. Burns. And he says to Homer, because they're disguised, he says, that's your next assignment. Go, do now. Throw a pie in the person's face. And then he says something to Smithers like,
he says, now push me around the park. I feel fussy.
And it's so great. It was Mr. Burns' big face on a little baby body. Smithers, Waylon Smithers is pushing him around. I'm watching like, boy, that's great.
That show, I mean, how many years has that show been consistent? Wow. I mean, it's amazing.
Most every year. Yeah. Every year that show is good.
In sports, pitcher Youngquan Bong, traded from Atlanta to Cincinnati, struck out 8 batters last week, leading the Louisville Bats to victory over the Indianapolis Indians in a 9-0 shutout.
That's got to be the first athlete Joe ever follows.
Absolutely.
Guy, last name is Bong?
Bong.
But this story isn't about the shutout.
Hey, what about when he gets a hit? That's a bong.
That's a bong. Well, the story isn't about the baseball game per se. It's about the fact that the game was held up for 15 minutes.
Tell us about it, Cheech.
While an Indians first baseman accidentally got locked inside the clubhouse restroom.
Oh, dear me.
What, John?
And finally,
no MSG in that story, Buzz.
If I were Chong, I'd be in prison.
Mm-hmm.
Finally, the rules are different in Germany.
Is that the one that you like screaming about? Is that the one that's in, which one is in jail
the
for selling bombs?
The one unfairly, unjustly imprisoned?
Tommy
Chong. Yeah,
right.
That's him.
Chong,
yeah.
Bong.
Plastic tobacco pipes, Don.
Chong Bong.
Finally, the rules are different in Germany. First, prostitution is legal there.
Hi, this is Wolfgang Juretzek from Germany.
From Germany.
Never forget.
Right.
The Don and Mike Show.
Thank you, Wolfram.
Second, the German government now says it'll levy fines against whorehouses that fail to hire trainees. All companies in Germany, regardless of their trade, are required to have at least one apprentice for every 15 paid employees.
You like this story, don't you, Buzz?
I do. Besides, the training's probably not a bad idea. I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
Okay, Buzz.
There he goes. Morning, man.
Okay, Buzz.
I am.
No, I don't want to go. Tie it in a knot tonight.
I haven't tried that.
That's it. We'll see you tomorrow with the new episode. Don't forget the Tron guy will be on Jimmy Kimmel tonight.
Very good.
Funny to see him on TV. Good day to you, sir.
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 You.
Good night, Captain Fuzzo.
Listen,
Chief. Spay and neuter your pets.
Eat a lot.
Till we meet again, this is Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.
This is the Don and Mike Show.